Congratulations. No, James, it's not a time to scrunch paper. Congratulations, you've successfully subscribed to the podcast of The Warm-Up.
Well done.
Well done. You've come through stage one. Stage two is listening. Stage three is turning it off. What a week we had this week. Ray Parler, Roger Daltrey, James Brown expecting a baby.
Yeah, it was great. Fantastic.
You certainly look pregnant, James.
Yeah, I'm...
The chubby snacker.
He is the chubby snacker. He really is.
Is there an HR department at TalkSport?
No, there isn't. There isn't. You just get handed a red card. That's all they do. Suddenly a red card appears on your desk, James.
Yeah.
Anyway, enough of our yakking. How did you enjoy the show this week?
Oh, it was great, wasn't it?
I thought it was pretty good. Yeah.
I enjoyed it very much. I really loved talking to Roger Daltrey.
It was legendary stuff from Roger.
Heavyweight guest.
A proper heavyweight guest.
Apart from when he sounded like we were stalking him.
Yeah, it did sound a bit weird.
Get away.
But also, I really wanted to raise a subject, which Gavin found out, that he said he likes fighting.
Yeah, he was up for a fight. I've seen him say it. And, when I was younger, I used to like a fight, but, and I still do. I think he meant it as a joke.
I still do.
Yeah, no, I think that was because he used to fight with Pete Townsend.
Do you think I was a bit lippy asking him when I said... every time he sings Hope I Die Before I Get Old, he looks like he's failed in his mission.
No.
So he's offended by that?
He must get that question every time.
He must get it all the time, Vaughan. It wasn't that good. You're not that original, mate. Go on, what?
Nothing.
Okay, well, anyway, here it is, the podcast of The Warm-Up that you can hear every week between 11 and 1 on TalkSport, thanks to Capital One, the credit card that supports the supporters. Here's your Warm-Up podcast. Good morning, welcome to The Warm-Up with me, Johnny Vaughan, on the day when AVB comes face-to-face with his former mentor, Jose Mourinho. It really is like, Obi-Wan Kenobi versus Skywalker up there, or maybe they're more Sith than that, I don't know. Tottenham play host to Chelsea at White Hart Lane. Arsene Wenger celebrates 17 years at Arsenal. Their game against Swansea live on TalkSport today at 5:30. But if you were born the day Wenger arrived... then today, just to give it some kind of perspective, you'd be eligible for a driving licence. Gareth Bale set to make his home debut at the Bernabeu, the Madrid derby, Real versus Atletico, also live on TalkSport this evening from 9 o'clock. Warming up alongside me, as ever. Yes, indeed, the printrepreneur, Jimmy Brown, the man with the definitive word on referees, the Woodman, Gavin Woods, ladies and gentlemen. Morning, lads.
Morning.
How are you? How are you, printrepreneur?
Yeah, I'm great.
That's James Brown.
I've not had any snacks this morning, so I'm in fine form.
Chubby snacker?
The slim snacker.
Yeah, do you know what? Since last week's show, we've been inundated with people talking about... Remember we were talking about the warm-up being prepared for style? What do you wear to the match?
Yes.
And as we went off the air, this bloke tweeted in, and we were all had us in tears.
Go on.
So we've got to start the show right away with that. He's a tweeter called @JohnLO1.
Yeah.
And he said, my mate Paddy, we were talking about the most ridiculous thing you've ever seen.
Yeah.
My mate Paddy's bird caught him cheating. She threw all his clothes out and he turned up at Ellen Road wearing a pair of her culottes. no shirt, just trainers and culottes. Paddy. That's going to take some beating.
Do you know what I love about it? I hope he can really go as well, because I like sort of androgynous people who can really go.
Are they a kind of three-quarter length, sort of baggy...
trawling for detail.
I don't know exactly what a culotte is.
They're shorts that look like a skirt until the woman starts to walk.
But they're long. A skirt with a bit in the middle.
They're like trousers made out of two skirts.
Yeah. But actually, they end up a little... If you look at old pictures of the Bay City Rollers, they all look like they've gone so baggy with the flair and so short. I don't want to say we're the only show that still does recaps on Bay City Rollers style.
Yeah. Up to the minute fashion.
We'll be taking a look at the Bay City Rollers and while they're setting a rocking new look around Great Britain. Shang-a-lang. warm-up says shang-a-lang-a-lang-a-lang a shooby-doo-way to a great new combo. Woodman.
Yes.
What's been the big story of your week?
Well, last week with the football, because we do talk about it now and again, was the Hull performance against Newcastle. They came back to win 3-2 at the end. It was absolutely brilliant. Steve Bruce's Hull, They played fantastic.
Tigers. I think the Tigers they are now.
The
really.
Hull Fire, I think James wanted to call them.
Hull Fire.
Hull Fire.
That's a much better name.
That's good. The Hull Fire
Hull
Club.
Hull Fire today. V Swansea.
That and the DiCanio, the DiCanio sacking, obviously, that was a story of last week. But, amazing.
A lovable eccentric bites the dust. He wasn't doing the business at all, was he, therefore?
No, he really wasn't. They're allowed catch up again.
Not lovable.
Well, it's quite. Do you know, we love a character in this country.
Everybody hated him. That's why he's been sacked.
Well, we love a character. Yeah. I mean, I thought he was on the way out when he banned singing, frankly.
And
you
ketchup.
Can't ban singing and ketchup.
That's too far. Make them train extra. Yeah. Throw their mobile phones in the sea. Everyone likes that. Yeah. You know, throw a football phone in the sea.
But if you're banning ketchup and singing, you're really not getting into the spirit of the English game, because I think that's the kind of muscle behind it. It's a ketchup-fueled industry.
It's the fuel of the game.
Is crying a part of the English game? Because the newspaper story of the week was on ESPN.
Yeah.
It's a media source.
Are you just doing a tenuous link here? Is crying part of the game? Because I've got another story for you, John. Let's keep that slickness permeating the show.
We've got to speed up. We've got loads on the show.
We have got a lot on the show. Go on.
The best story in the week, ESPN, have taken an extract from a new book coming out saying Jose Mourinho cried when he didn't get the Man United job. When David Moyes was appointed the Man United manager, it's quoting somebody from the sports agency Gestifute. Jose Mourinho did not stop calling. Those who he was talking to could hear him noisily sobbing, and word spread. The most feared man in the company was crushed. Oh, your manager, Chelsea, is a crybaby.
I don't believe he cried when he didn't get the Man United job. Do you know what that is? That's Red Devil propaganda, that is, mate. That's Red Devil propaganda. Don't go for it. Can I say, James is, we're going to talk about what we're warming up for today in a second, because already we've filled this section. But what James is really warming up today is Lisa, your missus, she's expecting a baby today.
Yeah, today. And, well, it's like me, I'm bad with deadlines. It's 2 days late, so it could be any time.
Yeah.
She wanted to know how to get in touch with me.
Okay, well, this Lisa, if you're listening, the way you can get in touch with the show and get in touch with James is the same as everyone else. If you start going into labour, or if you've got something, if you're not Lisa and you're not expecting James's baby, you get exactly the same means of communication as James's missus. So if you do want to get in touch with the show or you're James's missus and you need to get in touch with James, here's how you do it. Involved by calling the warm-up with Johnny Vaughan on 08717 223344, or email us via talksport.com. You can tweet us at TS Warm-up or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply. Leaves the studio. Great intonation as well, wasn't it?
He's got a lovely.
He's really got it. It's knocked out in China. That lovely summation tone. It's just all there. But you know what? He leaves. Roger arrives. Roger Daltrey, are you there?
Hello, Johnny. How are you?
Morning, Roger. How are you, matey?
Good.
Now, where are you calling from, Roger?
I'm calling from right out in the sticks. It's not a very good line, but I can just about hear you.
Okay, it's probably better, actually. We can hear you loud and clear, but I don't mind it being a one-way thing. First of all, Roger, just tell us a bit about your sort of football background. When did the game take with you? When did you start following football?
Well, I used to be Queen's Park Rangers supporter, when I was a kid. And then in the 60s, late 60s, I went and there was a really bloody fight in the times when football was getting really violent on the terraces. And I literally walked away from football completely.
Well, because you just didn't like
it turned me off so bad.
But Roger, I've also read something that said you in your life you didn't mind a fight.
No, but this was like it was just horrible,
nasty.
Really,
it was like just thuggery. It was horrible, and I really went off football until like the kind of mid-80s when I looked in the mirror of my car with my son in the back, taking him home on a school run.
Yeah.
and he's wearing an Arsenal scarf.
And suddenly you felt aggressive. course, suddenly I felt that old aggression come back.
An 8 year out of you know, supporting the team that they've made their mind up to support.
Yeah.
There's no way. So I had to take him, and I went along to Highbury, and I just fell in love with it all again, of course.
Oh, so it's a great day. You suddenly thought, you know what? You feel comfortable with this. You're with your boy. It bonds the two of you. And okay, it wasn't the Rangers, but that was it. You started going again.
Yeah, and I watch everybody. I mean, I just love the game. I try and watch every game that's on.
Did you ever play yourself?
I find it strange that a lot of supporters of teams don't watch anybody else. I find that really weird.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to kind of watch the other teams to know what your competition is.
But also, you can get involved. I find that I get involved in all games because I can always find a team that I like more than the other one. It's quite strange how, even when I watch like Tottenham Arsenal, I can suddenly find myself getting ludicrously involved with a side that if they're playing my lot, I wouldn't particularly care for.
That's right.
Did you play yourself ever, Rod? Did you ever play football?
No, I was a terrible football player.
Okay.
My legs wouldn't stop a pig in a passage.
Okay. But can I ask you, I know...
Have you got a pig in your passage?
I might have. That's my business. Now back off.
He's not happy, okay, the pig.
You know, on a farm here, you sometimes do get a pig in your passage.
Okay. He's
in the sticks. That's what they do out
there.
That's
what they do.
They put pigs in passages.
Roger, I know you're a massive... You've always been a big fisherman.
Well, actually, that's not true either.
Isn't it?
I like fishing. I like fishing because it's a... No, I was more into the aquaculture. I like the science of the early days of fish farming, and I was really interested in.
So it's
in
a
that
myth
side of it.
Because I once read an interview with you, and I think in a trout magazine.
Yeah.
And
well, that's what I was breeding. I was breeding trout.
Yeah, but it was quite a big interview with you. It was a very big interview, and I always find it quite curious that you didn't really talk about anything other than fish farming. And it was a sort of fish magazine,
because it was a very a young business, and there was a lot of bad practice going on, and I wanted to kind of improve it, and I succeeded in doing that. I was very proud of what I achieved in it, and all my farms that I used to own are owned by the workers now, so I'm proud of that too.
How many did you own?
I had four at the time.
You had four. So how many?
And I woke up on tour one morning in God knows where in America. After having this dreadful nightmare of all my managers calling me up and saying, look, we're resigning and we've got 4 million trout on the farm.
I've had that dream. Rog, we've all been there. What, the 4 million trout?
The extra trout.
The 4 million trout going AWOL dream.
The deep feeding, where are you?
Too many fish.
Roger,
you know like a good manager can spot a good young player early on. Could you spot a good trout early on?
Out of 4 million.
how would you define
of
a
course.
Good trout?
Yeah, what are you looking for in a young trout?
No, well, you don't look for anything as long as they're healthy.
Okay.
All the fish is food for another fish, really.
Yeah.
But you still want good quality if you're going to sell them as food.
Do you know what, though, Rog? I always use the trout farm as an analogy. I know this sounds weird. For what went wrong at Liverpool with Michael Owen and Robbie Fowler. Because I tell you why. Because I was watching a documentary on trout farming, yeah? And this guy always puts a pike in with his trout. To make sure the trout don't get too lazy,
so they keep swimming.
So they're sort of swimming around all the time, and so he put Rog like that.
Someone's pulling your leg.
Yeah, no. He said he shoved because he's got millions in there. So he used to put pike in there to make sure the trout were going, and they got muscle. They didn't just relax. They didn't chill. There was a predator in the water, and I noticed that when Robbie Fowler left Liverpool to go to Leeds United, Michael Owen was no longer as good, and neither was Robbie Fowler. So I've always used the trout farming analogy, where you've got to have a pike in the tank to keep the strikers moving. It's very good to keep that going, to keep the competition.
See, at Leeds, he became
the
pike. He became the pike at Leeds because we had five strikers. We didn't need another.
No.
But O'Leary used Fowler as the pike at Elland Road.
So it's trout farming syndrome. Rog, is it a myth then?
That's a great theory, though. I like that.
Yeah. Do you like that? That's Johnny Vaughan's trout farming pike theory. but don't quote me. Gav.
Roger, I got a question for you. When you recorded Won't Get Fooled Again and you did the big scream...
Yes.
Did you do that once? Or did the engineer go, nice one, Roger, can you do another one?
I did it for about half an hour.
Were you able to talk for the rest of the week? Because it's a big
yeah,
scream.
I've got one of those voices that can kind of I can brutalise it and still get away with it, yeah.
Rog, the other thing I wanted to ask you is, you know when you sing Hope I Die Before I Get Old? Do you ever feel you failed in your mission? I mean, when I see you sing it, when I see him sing it,
you think you're old. I mean,
I know, but
I've got mates who are 80, and they've got the spirit of a 16-year-old.
Okay, sometimes when I see you sing it, I'm thinking, I know rock and rollers sometimes have an entourage and are kept from the truth, but I'm thinking, you know, Rog, you know, you've made it past middle age.
Yes.
Okay, no reaction.
Thing is, though, they're still rocking the house. I saw The Who playing at the Super Bowl halftime. They absolutely rocked it.
I don't, you know, what's the rest got to do with it? I mean, and that lyric is just depends what you think age is. I think age is in the mind. It's not in the body.
Oh,
that's
you see,
one of the problems we've got with the ageing population.
Rog, as I'm nudging 50, I agree with you, mate. It's what's inside, right?
Hope I die before. Olds are like the old. 25-year-old.
I think in future, Rog, I mean, I'm not saying, just to make that clearer to men like me who are nudging 50, when you don't hope I die before I get old, could you touch your chest as though to say old inside? so we're more inspired by that.
Rog, is it true you were the last person to play at Highbury?
That's right.
Yeah, he did a song.
And you played with a brass band.
I sang on the pitch. That was a wonderful afternoon.
You even wrote the song for it, didn't you?
Yeah, I tried to do an old-fashioned traditional football song, you know.
What did you
like,
do?
That they used to have at the end of, you know, well, the beginning of the cup final at Wembley in the 60s and the 50s.
What would you say is your best day out ever at the football, Roger?
Pardon?
What's your best day out at the football?
Oh, I don't know. Most memorable, oh, God. I don't know, some of the Champions League games in the 2002-03 season. When we got into the final, that last few games there.
And when you're
I felt I'd aged about 50 years after someone was catching.
But can I ask you, Rog, when you're at the game, when you start singing, do people, when you start chanting, do people turn round and sort of say, shh?
Do they shout, who are you? Who are you?
I'm usually next to my son, who's got a louder voice than me, so they can't hear me.
Yeah, okay. I'm thinking.
So I'm very lucky there.
Do you ever lead the chanting?
Yeah.
Do you ever feel that urge to just get it going?
Like, why don't you give me an A, Roger Daltrey style?
Yeah, I think they could do with a few more melodies.
Yeah, definitely. Do you get royalties when people chant, who are you?
Rog, I read that your favourite player at Arsenal, you said one time, was Ray Parlour. Now, it's not gone unnoticed that he had very similar hair to you.
Yeah.
Mm.
Was that? Did you admire his hair as much as his...
I just love the haircut.
That was a Tommy era.
I loved Ray Parlour. I just thought he was a real, you know, ballsy British player. He never gave up. He'd run his heart out.
He's also a really, really good lad. He appears on the warm-up every week in a section of Ray's Parlour where specifically we use his football knowledge and cast it aside in favour of him just looking at player haircuts down at Ray Parlour. But is there anything you'd like to say to Ray? Any message you'd like me to give Ray a bit later?
I'd just like to thank him for all the great days of entertainment he gave me at the Highbury. He was a fabulous player.
Okay, I'll tell him that a bit later. Do you know what, he'd be made up, because sometimes before the game he needs something to distract him, but he'll love that.
Gav? Yes.
Have you had another question to ask Rog? Okay, no, it's about other... That's what I wanted to ask you. Have you ever had a situation when you're playing, like, festivals, and there are other sort of members of bands kicking around, and you find yourself in front of a telly with another big-name rock star, and you're both watching a game and kind of rooting for different sides? Have you ever had those situations?
Well, we had the European Cup, I think. Or the World Cup, I can't remember. No, European Cup. We were doing the Tea in the Park up in Glasgow. I think it was one of that, anyway, one festival or another. And it was Italy. I think it was it. Oh, God, who was it? Can't remember. This shows you my age now, doesn't it?
Yeah, you know, it doesn't at all. It shows you ours for not chipping in.
It was a lot. We were Pino Palladino, our bass player's Italian.
Right.
And there was someone else who was supporting the opposition. I think it was France.
How long ago was this?
It was 2005, 6, somewhere around then.
Okay, I'm just trying to
what
think.
What would that have been?
2005. I'm trying to think. I can't remember.
2004.
I was going to go back to, like, say 94.
No, 2006.
Okay.
So European Cup.
And there was real rivalry there between the two?
Yeah.
did it kick off? Was it reminiscent of the QPR days?
No, it wasn't that kind of rivalry.
Okay. I was surprised when I read the quotes and it actually said you quite like to fight and you still do. Oh, that's a great thing for Roger to admit. Listen, Roger, thank you so much for talking to us and taking time out today. Look after yourself, enjoy the football, and thank you very much for joining us, joining the warm-up. Roger Daltrey, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Roger.
All right, cheers. Thank you so much. Roger Daltrey there. He's a massive fan of Ray Parlour. Ray Parlour will be up next. Do you know what? Let's take a trip to Ray's Parlour. He's got all the style for us.
Hello, and welcome to Ray's Parlour. This is the dawning of the
Ray is waiting for us in his parlour. It's a temporary parlour today. Ray, where are you?
Hello, Johnny.
All right, Ray.
I'm at Villa Park. I'm looking out on this fabulous pitch at Villa Park. But a memory's coming back to me when Ryan Giggs scored that wonder goal.
Yes.
You know, in the semi-final of the FA Cup in 99 when he took his shirt off and he had that chest of hair under his shirt. But, you know, it's all coming back to me now. It was a very disappointing game that was for us.
Yeah. Who's the hairiest player you've ever seen?
I think it must be Ryan. I mean, Ryan was pretty hairy, wasn't he?
He was hairy.
He was
get a second jumper on.
Yeah, like the doormat on front.
A superb goal.
It was a brilliant goal.
What's weird about that is he never scored another one sort of like it. I never saw another jinking, amazing, diving run
I always say
you can do it against Arsenal, you should be able to do it against everyone.
It was into extra time and it was a really tight game. We missed the penalty last kick of the game. Dennis Bergkamp, Michael saving. And then he I think it's Patrick Vieira, give a ball away on the halfway line. He's not going to score from there. We've got people like Martin Keogh and Lee Dixon, they're going to take him out before he gets to the box, and they didn't, and he went through and scored, and what a wonderful goal. And that's probably one of the best FA Cup goals ever.
I think it must be. Yeah, but do you know the thing about FA Cup goals? It's more about the timing, I think, than the execution. That's the best executed. Mm. And actually, it also had the time factor as well.
Well, they had 10 men as well. They had 10 men.
Yeah, 10 men. It's got timing and it's got grace and style. It probably is.
They had 9 men and a gorilla.
it reminded a bit like your goal against Chelsea.
It's a King Kong on the wing. He might do something.
Your goal against the Tim Lovejoy goal that you scored.
Oh yeah. You know, there's only Ray Parlour, but he's probably right because they're the much better players on the pitch than me. Like the
it was
Dennis
an important
Bergkamp,
goal though.
Thierry Henry's and people like that. But yeah, it was a wonderful goal. I must admit.
Ray, there's nothing Ray likes talking about more than the great goals of Ray Parlour.
Yeah.
Ray Parlour this morning talking about Ray Parlour.
Ray, when you came off after that match, obviously you were gutted. You knocked out of the cup. When you were talking about the goal, were the Arsenal players impressed with the quality of the goal or the amount of chest hair?
I think it was the quality of the goal. Okay. We all looked at each other and said, Martin had his red boots on. He kicked everyone, moved Martin Keown, and he could have took him out, to be fair. So we're all looking at him. But Dennis Bergkamp, he missed a penalty. Felt sorry for Dennis. He didn't speak for a week.
Thought just because you gave him a kicking.
We felt really sorry for Dennis because he's a great lad and a great
perfectionist,
player.
Wasn't
he was gutted. He was absolutely gutted.
Right, as an insider thing, how if you really do bear a player a bit of ill will because they have missed a penalty, how do you sort of convey that tactfully?
No, it's one of them.
Is it one of them?
You don't really need to, though.
It happens. People like Dennis Bergkamp has won so many games for us. He was one of the best players. Probably the best player I played with. So, you know, people do miss penalties. It was a good save from Schmeichel as well. It's different if sometimes you miss the target, but he hit the target and Schmeichel went the right way. And it's a little bit of luck sometimes.
It is.
You know, you need a bit of luck when the keeper is going to move. But Schmeichel was a great keeper as well, wasn't he? I mean, I played with David Seaman, who was brilliant. But Peter Schmeichel was up there with David Seaman. Probably, you know, people will say he's probably better.
Ray.
We've got the Man City players, haven't we?
I know we've got Man City, but do you know what, Ray? I'm not so sure. I'm really not so sure. Demichelis isn't playing today, and I think he was the hair we were really looking for.
Yeah, he's the one who's slick back, isn't it? You know, yeah. He's got it like a Vaseline look. He puts a bit of Vaseline so it doesn't move.
Most of them
are similar, aren't they? Nazari, you've got Aguero, Negredo. I think they must have an in-house barber who does exactly the same to everybody.
Are you getting jealous, Ray? Are you getting jealous?
I just thought they should do that at clubs, shouldn't they? Everybody should have the same haircut. fantastic.
Theo Walcott's hair never changes. He must get it cut every day.
Action man hair.
He has. I've been monitoring it since he started. It's so neat. It's like Lewis Hamilton.
Oh, it's
fantastic.
He's
got that same neat deal going on.
He's a good lad, Theo Walcott.
But he always
looks immaculate as well, Theo. He's got some great clothes. He's one of them. I played in the Arsenal Golf Day this year, and he came over, and he had his team with his dad there and his brother. Yeah. They had the matching outfits on. They looked fantastic.
Oh, no.
Seriously, red shirts, white trousers.
Even his old man had matching outfits.
They look fantastic, I promise
you. It's a bit bloody weird, if you ask me. Me and my old man have never... No, it's not good, Ray.
It was a golf day.
I know you're Arsenal mad, but Ray, you can just back off a second. I'm going to tell you why. Because any man who turns up at golf with a matching outfit to his dad is just strange. And so is his dad.
There must have been a prize for it then, I don't know. There must have been a prize who could be look the smartest. And
who could look like the weirdest husband, son and dad. This was the warm-up on TalkSport, thanks to Capital One, credit card that supports the supporters. Thank you very much for the show, fellas. Tremendous stuff. Focused.
Thank you, Johnny.
Concise. Welcome to your warm-up podcast, joined as ever by the Woodman, Gavin Woods.
Hello.
Vinny Woods, as he was this week. This week we were looking at, what were we looking at?
Roy Keane's beard.
Roy Keane's beard, which Gavin, you compared to...
Well, like a beard that someone had drunk some cream out of a bowl.
Yeah.
With.
At which point it was suggested that that's how Roy's wife feeds him. She has
a secure room.
Roy's
hatch.
Roy's is the only room in the house that's not secure. It's a panic house. and Roy lives in the room that's fine. Everyone else can leave that room and go into
that.
That
implies that somebody would break into Roy's house.
Yeah, that wouldn't be right. Yeah.
You wouldn't want
that
to be
that.
That
would be as stupid as breaking into Duncan Ferguson's house.
That was brilliant, that
was. Put that with the guards and he's attacking the dog for Roy.
Duncan, this was in
the guards are there.
These were in the days when you could attack a burglar and not be sent to jail for it.
Well, burglars burgled Duncan Ferguson's house, and the burglars called the police, didn't they?
Anyway, I enjoyed the show this week. There was no Premiership action to talk about, we had a packed show,
and we had loads of response from the public on the tweets, didn't we?
The big Twitter subject was this is no offence to them. I really hope I haven't cheesed them off because I know they actually. I don't really care. It's just
the
that
band.
England band.
Do you know what we should do here?
What?
Why don't I just read out everyone who's tweeted the names, not the tweets, because then they'll keep doing it.
Okay, go on then.
Okay, so we have got Kyle Gavigan, Joe B, Fetch Arts, Gob GSB Gooner, Matthew Ketchell, David John, Dave Clark, Neil Sanger again, Ian Wade, Alan Hall, GBD, Neil Bell, Rational Eric, Dr. Lionel Gentlefist.
Rational Eric is one of the best nicknames I've ever.
Rational Eric.
Hey, there's millions of them, because as I was trying to point out, it is like, if you imagine Gladiator, and you've got the theme tune from Coronation Street coming in.
It
really does.
Football and brass.
It's just the way they play.
It's so doleful and depressing.
Well, it's an international football with like a team that they wouldn't even make the promenade of a small seaside town.
If we mention all of these tweeters, they'll all download the podcast.
That's a good point.
They're famous. Rational Eric is the bloke who told us that he'd worked with David Batty's mum.
Oh, that's right. Hey, what was your tweet of the week? Didn't you have one from Irvin Welsh?
Yeah, Irvin Welsh said that whenever you approach international break, it's always like knowing relatives you've got to see
at Christmas
come round. You know you've got to see him, but you don't want to.
That's brilliant.
And that's just some
we
of
should
that.
Get Irvin on the phone.
Let's
because he's a he's a big Hibs fan, but he lives in Chicago.
Does he?
And he's got a house in Miami. So if you follow him on Twitter, he's always cutting between Hibs and Hearts.
Yeah.
And like, you know, Miami Fury or whatever he supports over
he's
there.
He's a good lad, and it's the sort of cat.
And that film's brilliant. That new film he's got, Filth.
Is it good?
It's really good.
It was a good book. Yeah, that's about the policeman.
Yeah, it's the best post-Trainspotting book he wrote.
It was, it's better than I think.
The film
so.
Is really good.
Well, no, I wouldn't put it in the. I'd say it's the post-Filth era. I'd say that's not where he tailed off, but I enjoyed that book immensely. Anyway, I enjoyed that book. I hope you enjoy the podcast.
Enjoy.
Good morning, welcome to the warm-up with me, Johnny Vaughan, on the day when England fans are starting to dust off their thongs. in preparation for Brazil, 2014. The international break means that the biggest fixture of the day is Orient versus the MK Dons. It's a biggie. Ray Parlour is there. And the third qualifying round of the FA Cup gives teams like Biggleswade Town, Concord Rangers and Canvey Island the chance to dream the impossible dream. Warming up alongside me, the Printrepreneur himself. Who's the daddy? Why, he is.
Morning.
James Brown's here. Morning, James.
Morning.
And the man
you?
With the definitive word on referees, the Woodman, Gavin Woods. Timber! Morning, morning, Woodman.
Morning, Johnny.
How are you this morning?
Very well, how are you?
I like that. Yeah, you were really talkative around the back, and then just when I went, morning, went, morning.
Yeah, I'm just... Hello, just
no, really,
I'm busy over here.
Really just acting like you popped into a really normal office. Morning, John, can't really talk.
Yeah, I've just got some emails.
Yeah, hang on a second, I'll take some stuff here. Morning, John. Did anyone see my envelope?
I need those figures.
I left an envelope on the table. James, congratulations.
Thank you.
Could I say, congratulations. With all that... what a week you've had.
That was a bit tricky last week.
What'd you have?
Little boy.
James, with James Brown having a little boy last week, he's back with us. You know, new love has entered his life. His missus must be looking serene, bathed in the light of fresh life. And it's a time for Gavin and I to say to you...
Leeds United. What the trouble that's happened at United is we cannot get finance for club
at Leeds United.
Leeds United.
We missed it last week.
Yeah.
Oh, we missed you, matey. We missed you.
So you had a midwife that looked like Emil Heskey. Is that right?
You know, I thought that was bad after. I thought that was not a good thing.
There's nothing wrong with that. Some people, a lot of guys are into that.
My wife looks like Sebastian Vettel.
I've gone out on the pool and I've seen this cracking Emil Heskey looking like, and I thought, that is a bit of me, that is a bit of me.
Actually, you know, people moan about the National Health Service and all that, and it was brilliant. It was fantastic. They were great. The ladies at university and college.
Yeah, because you're famous, you get special treatment, don't you?
it was
actually fantastic. We had three members of staff there asking me to sign
things.
We had
millions of members of staff.
Did you?
If you want to get a baby at the UCH
Hospital.
UCH, University College Hospital, London. Yeah. Fantastic.
You had great treatment there.
It was brilliant. Okay. It was fantastic. It was better than last kid.
I've heard you were like promising them tickets to like Capital One games.
I've actually
like
invited them down to the show.
I expected a whole team here, whole medical team. Anyway, James, congratulations.
Thank you. And
once more.
Leeds United. If you'll come down to Leeds United.
Anyway, let's stop that. We've got a big warm-up for you today. Andros Townsend, eh?
Yep. Yeah.
What a goal!
And Walker. Him and Walker together looked very tidy on the right.
But guys, let's get it straight. I read in the Times this morning, little sign of fear factor for England. I'm thinking, you know what? They're playing Montenegro. That's like the equivalent of sort of Arsenal versus Biggleswade.
No, it's
Arsenal showing no signs of fear today against Biggleswade.
Like, Montenegro is the same size as Nottingham.
Yeah, there you go.
That's put it into perspective.
That does put it in perspective.
But they're right, because when you watch the last England game, Walcott was terrible.
Yeah.
And the nation and the press gets this fear of, oh my God, we've only got the 11 players that are in the team.
Yeah.
What happens if they don't play? I know, let's get Kevin Davis.
Yeah.
Let's get a bulldozer in.
Yeah.
Actually, the reality is, Roy Hodgson does really well, just tinkering with a little bit. Mm. Put one new player in, change a player there. Mm. He's very confident in just putting the best player in the position who's on form. Walcott won't get back into the team.
Did you see last night, though, that when Roy Hodgson was just leaving, it made me laugh. Roy Hodgson was at the end, they just cut to him at the end of the game, and he had some keys in his hands. I think he's already thinking about driving that coach in there. He just looked like he's thinking, right, lads, let's get out of here before we get caught in traffic.
No drinks.
Go on. No,
you can
drink on the way back. We'll stop. I know a little off license just outside Wembley.
I didn't notice it last night, but one of the most prominent things about Roy on a match day
his flaming red eyes?
His enormous watch.
It's a present from players.
It's the size of a 1970s glass ashtray.
He's got an Audemars Piguet. That's worth 65 grand on his
really
wrist.
Expensive.
It's about 65,000 feet wide.
I think it's £65,000 in weight.
Yeah.
For people ice skating on that watch.
But do you know what it looks like? I do what it looks a bit like.
You know what that watch is then? Is it a top watch?
It's Audemars Piguet. Yeah, but it looks a bit like, you know when people, you go on holiday and you get a watch for like your granddad that's sort of inappropriate off like one of the looky-looky men on the beach.
Yeah,
it looks like that, doesn't it? It looks
your
like
granddad right now is looking at his watch and tapping it.
Granddad, I bought you a watch on the beach.
A giant watch that weighs half an ounce.
Too trendy for him. And he's sort of also got like a brand new bum bag. They got him as well on the front with like Winston on it. Right, let's move on. Yeah. But anyway, little sign of the fear factor last night. I just don't think that's worth celebrating. The other thing that annoys me is you keep looking at them, like where England are in the group, and they're top of the group.
They are.
But still, there must be time for nerves because they've got to rely on the fact that Poland won't. You think we're top of the group? Can we just relax?
Yeah, but
why is it always so tough?
There's only one more game, and if we don't win it, we have to go to a playoff, which is really annoying.
They'll fix that.
The reality of it is, most people who comment on football, us fans and the journalists, they haven't got a clue. We haven't got a clue, really.
We haven't. There's only one man I've come to the conclusion who's got a clue. Sepp Blatter.
Oh, yeah. He knows everything.
Now, just on the subject of Sepp.
The bladder that matters.
Yeah, it's the bladder that matters. Exactly right. Weak bladder. we've got a very strong bladder in charge. What have you called your son, James?
Sepp.
Good man. what Gavin and I enjoy about Sepp Blatter is that his real name is...
Josep.
So he's using the last syllable of his first name.
As the shortening.
Sepp Blatter. That's quite rare in history.
Mm. It's good, though.
But if you look at some of the people, men of power around the world...
It's usually the first half.
It's not. Like, for instance...
Well, you could have Don Brown or...
Gordon Brown or...
Yeah. Ron Reagan
or Burt Mugabe.
Burt Mugabe. He doesn't call himself Burt, does he?
No.
It wasn't Dolph Hitler, was it?
No, Rhett Thatcher.
Rhett Thatcher, exactly.
Or Lex Ferguson.
Del Castro.
Dross Townsend.
That's actually brilliant.
We should all do it.
Yes. We've got to get people to tweet.
Knee Vaughan.
Yeah, Knee Vaughan. Yeah, Vinny Woods. Vinny Woods.
Mess Brown.
Everyone knows Mess. Do you know
it's
Mess?
It's messy.
Brown. Nothing messy Brown's all right.
I'm all right with that.
Nothing beats Burt Mugabe, though.
No, it doesn't.
No, you can't. Anyway, I like this second half. What you missed last week is that we've done a big show U-turn on the Winter World Cup.
We're right behind Blatter.
We're behind Blatter for a winter wonderland. We think it is brilliant because at the moment we're losing 6 weeks out of the league season because of England games anyway. Like today, we got no Premiership action. I'm sorry, England versus Montenegro. Who does it work for? It works for FIFA. It works for Montenegro. It doesn't work for us.
No.
It really doesn't. We've got to miss a whole week.
I'm with you on the idea of the Winter World Cup, but I disagree. I'm glad when the Premiership doesn't on. It means you said the best game of the day is Orient v the Dons. That's right. MK Dons. That's the best game for football. Yeah. But in about an hour, it's the Mouth Derby.
Hey?
It's the Mouth Derby. Plymouth versus Portsmouth. I know they're not that near each other, but they're both beginning with P.
Really. They've got mouth at the end.
I was thinking, like, Barcelona play Real Madrid, they call it the El Clasico. So I was trying to work out what is that. Is that all I could come up with was the
big mouth.
El Pocalypso.
Oh, very good.
Lipso.
Oh, very good.
Or the Calypso.
When James said that, his racy pun was greeted with hilarity, I'm satisfied to recall.
Yeah, I noticed in the group England are in, San Marino have let in 46 goals and scored one.
Listen, today on the show, because we've got a bit of time, I've had a master plan of completely rescheduling the whole of the football season. Because it occurs to me that all this stop-starting, it just stops you...
So annoying.
It's stopping people engaged with the season. Yeah. I'll give you an example, yeah? The X Factor. They don't have, like, two shows, then they're going to take a week off because ITV are going to run another show just for a couple of weekends. Then they're going to come back in, have a little run of four, and then they're going to switch to
it's the football equivalent of an ad break.
They do that. ITV do that with I'm a Celebrity. They just bin it to show a football match.
Well, yeah, but it is on every night. So it's
a bit
different.
You come back and Ray Winston or somebody's been bitten by a snake and he's left the show.
Ray's never been on that show. Don't even say it about the governor. I won't have that. I'll get him on the phone and there'll be trouble.
The snake's left the show.
Okay, fair enough. Here's how you get in touch with us. Here's the details. Get involved by calling the warm-up with Johnny Vaughan on 08717-22-3344 or email us via talksport.com. You can tweet us at TS Warmup or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply. little sign of the fear factor when England take on the might of Montenegro. That's what the Times goes with today. And they're absolutely right. There's little sign of the fear you get when you see those what are they called?
Montenegrins.
Oh, that's something shocking there. Whoa, I don't know if that was acceptable. The Montenegrins coming out that tunnel, I tell you what.
Nothing was as scary as Roy Keane's beard.
Okay, let's just talk about this. Let's talk us through the beard. Roy Keane, what's the deal?
Where was Roy Keane?
He's got a full beard.
Where was he?
He was punditing.
By the look of it, he spent the week with Tintin.
On TV last night.
Yeah, yeah.
That wasn't Roy Keane.
Yes, it was.
That was that guy that used to run Iran.
No, that was when he was captured. To be fair, Saddam had a moustache.
Not Iraq.
Oh, right, Iraq, sorry.
Iran.
Because Saddam Hussein only had the beard at the very end when he came out of that pit in his wife fronts.
No. But he did have...
And I wish he'd come out of that pit with two Uzis. Yeah. I thought, how unimpressive he'd come out like that.
It.
No, he should have opened up the pit. He should have come out with guns blazing.
It's rubbish the way they find them in a drain.
I know.
It's really difficult.
The machine Scarface.
Yeah, exactly right. He should have come out of there, say hello to my little friend. He should have come out in nothing but a pair of jockey wife fronts, couple of Uzis.
You want to go to what?
Yeah. You mess with Saddam, eh? Say hello to my little...
Seriously, though, these blokes, Hitler, Libya, what's he called, Gaddafi... They all end up on the ground in a little hole.
Yeah, no,
it's rubbish.
But there's gold taps down there with them.
Yeah.
Gold bathroom taps.
James Brown's bunker theory. It's always the thing that we love after a dictator's been ousted. Let's see the bathroom finish. Yeah. Go on, let's see. I don't care about the cruel things. I want to see how he's done it.
It's a lovely Milano marble wall finish.
$8,000 a tap. Yeah. You're not going to believe it. He had rubies to signify hot. And he had sapphires to signify gold. $20,000 them taps.
But Roy did look terrifying.
There's a book of it. Peter York did a book.
Did he?
Dictator Chic. It's amazing. It's a great book.
Hey, wait a second. Let's get back on football. Because we were talking about... we've got two sidetracked with dictator names. What with Burt Mugabe and stuff.
Yeah.
Gav, that beard. I thought Roy Keane looked like Captain Haddock.
But a really scary younger version when he was in the sort of special boat service or something.
Roy O'Clooney. He's gone for that look, hasn't he?
It's all dark and then there's a white bit like he's been lapping from a bowl of cream or something. Do you know what I mean? Really scary, though.
That's how Roy Keane's wife feeds him.
In contrast to Theo Walcott's pedicure.
Oh my god.
His haircut is so perfect.
I'm obsessed with it.
It's like an action man haircut.
It's like, exactly right. Your action man grows hair faster than Theo Walcott.
It's not a
that you play with action man anymore.
No.
But the idea of Roy Keane,
it looks like
he's been lapping at a bowl of milk. I like the idea that Roy's... No, I like the idea that Roy's frightened wife just opens a section in the bottom of the door.
He comes clawing his way out.
Slides his...
He eats with his dogs.
Hey, Nathan, just pass through there. My milk's coming through the bottom of the door, dude. And the girls just pass through the milk.
She leaves his food out in the outhouse with the two dogs he's got.
Passes me milk, I've been playing with the horses. They passed them to the dog. Am I going
to get in trouble with that? Am I
in trouble?
No.
Right,
maybe with Roy.
Can I just set the Twitter thing this week. We always start the Twitter conversation midweek here on there at TS Warm-Up.
You mean you?
TS Warm-Up.
Okay.
On the show's Twitter feed, at TS Warm-Up. And I was thinking, where do footballers eat? They got a lot of money.
Yeah.
If you get all the places where they eat, you're going to get a great guide to a load of great restaurants.
Yeah, yeah.
As it turns out, most of them are eating burgers at Fleet Services.
Do you know why Fleet Services is so good?
Why?
Because he got burgers. James Beattie favours the burger.
Come on. You haven't spent enough time on the road, mate. The Fleet Cheek. The Fleet Cheek is a service road. You can use it as a junction. That's why. Don't see it as a service station. Sales reps and men in the know. The Fleet Cheek? Not many.
So anyway...
Remember, it's 18 miles between junctions where Fleet comes. You can just slap in there. You're onto a country service road, out of traffic. Nice.
Lovely.
Although illegal, and the show in no way condones that. Do you know what? You're asking what a footballers eat. There's one man who could tell us, and he's up right now. Ladies and gentlemen, this week's guest, Alex McLeish. Somebody go get the ass kicked. Somebody go get the wheel kicked. Somebody go get the ass kicked. Somebody go get the wheel kicked. Every week we talk to one of soccer's hard men. I'm just kidding. Alex, are you there?
Yes, I'm here, John.
Not too bad. How are you today, Alex? You all right?
Yeah, I was listening to that conversation. It was pretty thrilling. You know, I don't think Roy Keane will be too happy if he's listening to you.
No, he won't, actually.
I think he'd be quite happy with the Clooney one, but maybe no Ahmadinejad, you know, the Iran leader.
but he is going for a bit of dictator chic. He is, actually, I've got to tell you, of all the dictators that have ever walked this earth, I find Roy Keane a good deal more intimidating.
Yeah, much scarier.
Lord alone knows what a Roy Keane-run state would be like.
Yeah, it'd be scary.
He'd expect everyone to be like Roy Keane, just like his footballers.
Anyway, miserable.
Alex, we were talking about where footballers eat, yeah? At the clubs you've been in, yeah?
Yes.
Where do footballers eat?
Where do they eat?
Yeah, where do they eat? What are they genuinely like? I mean, obviously, you have a Spronzy night out, but generally, what does a British footballer like to eat?
Well, I think the British footballer is pasta really orientated. It's the normal. Even when after a game, they want to fill up with pasta and reload with the carbohydrates. Yeah. You know, I know what you're saying about the service station and things. There are old habits die hard. Yes, beef bouillon or the odd burger, you know, so... Yeah,
Alex, have you ever... I mean, I always think that when footballers now have to eat very healthily, yeah, it's all about the diet and they've all got these sort of sports scientists, biologists and all these people sort of looking at them. Have you ever caught a player out, kind of like an addict, having a relapse? But have you ever caught one? You've just caught a player and you've just seen him just heading off for a fry-up or seen him at a drive-in McDonald's and thought, busted.
Yep. I can tell you an example. Way back in my Scotland days, as my first time manager job was at Motherwell, and we saw the opposition. We were playing Hibs that day, and Hibs from Edinburgh, and I drove up to the stadium at Motherwell, and I think some of the Hibs players were Glasgow based. So they were meeting the team at the ground rather than going through to Edinburgh to go on the bus to come into the back in towards Glasgow. So we passed the chip shop and there was a couple of the star players coming out with fish and chips just before the game.
But I tell you what, though, they might have gone there for a Mars bar supper. Seriously.
Alex.
Remember the Mars bar supper? I know it's a myth down here, but it's quite extraordinary when you do see a Glaswegian going in there, especially if they're quite an aggressive Glaswegian woman, which happened to me, and they shove in front of you and you go, and they just give you that hard stare and they go, three fish suppers, please, and two Mars suppers. Three fish suppers, please, and two Mars suppers. I'm thinking some lucky children she's got. What a lovely treat to get pudding and the main course in one.
Alex, when you were managing Motherwell and you saw the Hibs players coming out full of fish and chips, did it affect your team talk?
Yeah.
Did you say to the lads, get stuck into him, he's had double chips and scraps?
He's going to be slow today.
And scraps.
Oh, listen, it did. I mean, it did, in terms of the professionalism, you would think, leading up to a game like that, I'd just say to the players, look, I don't think these guys have prepared well. So...
when they were in the queue for the chip shop, were they doing light stretching while they were waiting?
No, I've seen them munching them outside, you know, putting salt vinegar on, usual salt vinegar. I think probably a pickled egg was thrown in there as well.
What I want to know is, how do you feel if you're a Hibs fan, you've come all the way from Edinburgh, and you pass two of your star strikers, and they're there just sort of...
having a pickled egg.
Just staring into space outside a chap shop.
I went on to manage Hibs after that, and I quickly got these guys out the door.
How do you
to the chip shop?
How do you prepare your own players? Are you very strict about diet?
Yeah, we were always very careful about pre-match meals and things like that. But when I go back to my Aberdeen days, when Alan McLeod was the manager, then Billy McNeil, and then Sir Alex came in, it was in those days we were eating steaks pre-match meal. It was incredible,
The players' lunch.
Not chips, but steaks.
Well, you don't want to mix meat and potatoes. That's carbohydrates and protein. Gad, is that that's a bad combination?
Correct.
It's a bad combination, isn't
carbs
it?
Carbs for afterwards for recovery.
Yeah, is that right?
Yeah, apparently.
Thanks,
yeah.
Gad. That was too filling.
That was too filling, you know, with potatoes as well. But with definitely steak, and that was our favourite. Oh, steak was an absolute godsend to a lot of the guys coming from, the streets in Glasgow, and to go right into that in Aberdeen in your first professional club. But after that, you know, then there was the rise of pasta. You know, the players were reading.
I tell you, Alex, hang on a second, because that is what you should call your autobiography. Alex McLeish, The Rise of Pasta. The Rise and Fall of Pasta.
Huge wave of spaghetti.
Yeah.
Well, spaghetti with baked beans.
How do you yourself prepare for a game? What tends to be your match day regime?
The day of the game, then it's normally, we used to do pre-match lunches, but because there's a lot of players now travel quite far, and to bring them in really early, 3 hours before the game, is sometimes a little bit of a chore, you know. I know that you'll say, well, professionals, they should be able to do that, but we did find we had problems with that, you know, both at Rangers, and the players asked if they could come in closer to kick-off, but we had to say to them to be careful about what they were eating at home and not eating too soon, you know, too close to kick-off.
Yeah.
So we had to try and trust them, and you know, playing at the top level, then you would like to think you've got the players who would do that, but... Yeah. You know, we found even at Rangers with some great Dutch internationals, they were coming in at 1 o'clock. So 1 o'clock was for a 3 o'clock kickoff. Normally you'd been for 12 pre-match, 3 hours before.
Yeah.
But they were coming in at 1 o'clock and they were starting to ask the chefs for scrambled eggs and omelettes and all that. You know, I'm saying, no, we're going to go back to the 12
a
o'clock.
Pre-match omelettes.
No.
Get in there.
Yes.
Alex, can I ask you something? Because I often, all my life, I've looked at, well, not all my life, but since I've been able to hear, I've listened to the football results coming in, and I'd sort of look around, and I imagine these far-flung places in Scotland you've got there. And you've managed in England. But I want to know, what is, after a defeat, what is the most depressing homeward journey a man can have? Is it driving through England, or sometimes when you're coming back from, I don't know, somewhere, right up in Scotland, and you just
Inverness.
Face that... Inverness, and you're facing that... Which is the most depressing post-defeat journey home for you?
In Scotland?
Yeah. No, in England or Scotland, what for you is the one? Football in its bleakest.
Going from you know, the furthest reaches to come back. But the thing about travelling in the Premier League is that you normally, if you're going to Sunderland or Newcastle or something, then the club hire a plane anyway, you know, so that turns into a very short journey.
Okay,
It's probably the ones, you know, kind of in the cusp of getting a plane, like up north in Manchester.
Okay, what about in Scotland? What would you say is the coach journey from hell?
Well, we were in Aberdeen. We were traveling every other week, and you know, we had long journeys every second week, so that's why we had to make sure we won every week. And
you got that in, didn't you?
In the Alec Ferguson days, that was, of course, but certainly, if you're going to Inverness or something, you're playing in Glasgow. When I was at Rangers, then we played Inverness. I think we get a bad result was getting a draw at places like that at the times. We had some really tremendous world class players.
Yeah.
And then you had to travel all the way down, and knowing that you were going to be getting absolute bombarded by the press and your fans over the next week or so.
Yeah. Grim times on that coach, I bet. Grim, grim. Who can know how a man feels as he journeys back from Inverness, when the game was 50-50 anyway, after a nil-niller? Who can know? Well, I tell you exactly who can know. Ladies and gentlemen, he's been our wonderful guest today. The man, the legend. Somebody's going to get his ass kicked, but it's not going to be Alex McLeish! Thank you so much for talking to us, Alex, and giving us those dietary insights that we hanker for. I was watching England last night, and I'm afraid I think I know what's been dragging us down.
What?
All this time. It's that band.
No, it's
it's so dull.
I can't stand them. Please. I know. The point is if you want your side to be good, and play, you've got to have a band that are playing at the top of their game.
Yeah.
Can I say to them, no offence, lads, I know you try, but...
Yeah, lots of offence.
You're dreary.
Don't hold back. They're rubbish.
They're
Everyone
rubbish.
Hates them.
They're dreary, monotonous. They're the Morris men of... They're the Morris men of English football.
They
you
are.
Make us minnows with your great escape theme. You drag us down with your
boring, awful version of God Save the Queen, which is an insult to Queen Anne's country.
It's the wrong song for the football.
You don't inspire fans. You don't inspire players. I'd rather have a red button so I could just have... I'd rather have the Brazilian crowd.
Yeah. Also, there's so many songs that they could do.
I know. Yeah.
There's the whole jazz catalogue.
Your dreary little selection drives me mad. I know you're going to hate me for it, lads. And I know you've been... But I think, you know what? I'll say it fair and square. You're the problem. The players come out and they think, wherever they are, they think, oh, great.
Not again.
They've followed us here. Oh, I've gone all the way to the Faroe Islands.
They could play, Reward by Teardrop Explodes.
Yeah. Or There's No Limit.
They're awful.
God, it's like a funeral. I know, it's horrible.
Leave us alone. Yeah. You belong in a bygone era. Now be gone to that era.
Kev Elkin, at TS warm-up. I seen Kyle Walker drinking pink champagne in the Ivy last year.
Oh, posh. Did you?
Kyle, I didn't.
Did he?
Yes, did he have his little finger put
Kev Elkin. Kev Elkin at Elk147. He's our man at the Ivy.
Thank you very much indeed for all your texts about footballers eating. Warming up, we've got our match day predictions. And if I caused any offence to that band, I'm really sorry, but you've been driving me mad for years. Get involved by calling the warm-up with Johnny Vaughan on 08717-22-3344 or email us via talksport.com. You can tweet us at TS Warm-Up or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply. This is the warm-up team, and you're about to listen to the podcast. Woodman, what did you make of the show this week? A bit messy at the start and a bit messy at the top.
It started off riotous, but we had so much to get through, we had to almost, didn't we?
James, you can explain why it was. What was wrong with you today?
He's got baby lag.
I've been like up all night with a baby. I've got baby lag.
Was it the first time you've been amongst adults for a while?
It's the first time I have spoken to an adult male in 5 days. I've been looking at a 10-day-old baby in a onesie.
Because at the start of the show, you were a little bit like... You know when you see dogs getting let out at service stations?
And they're so excited.
When they get let out the boot just for a bit of a stretch.
You told me not to mention dogs in boots.
But they just go mad and they just sort of move around. You're a little bit like that. It wasn't quite Who Fed the Puppy, but it really was like watching a dog.
I think it was. I was a bit
stir
crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
I've been up at 3 o'clock in the morning seeing 10 green bottles. Do you know how many green bottles have smashed at my house this week?
10?
No, every night we've been doing 10 green bottles. I've segued it in.
Your kid's a week old, you're doing 10 green bottles.
I've got to try and get him to go to sleep.
You know, it's just all wrong, conceptually it's wrong. They don't even know what a green bottle is yet.
What's become very clear, the wall is faulty.
You just explained to him what you're drinking.
You should be singing Slipknot tunes.
Yeah, seriously.
There he is there.
But is it because that every night he actually watches you demolish 10 green bottles of, like, wine? Do you actually sing it as you drink? Thank you very much to Capital One for the onesies they've given us, which have got our monogrammed.
Here they are.
And if you want to get on the show, tweet us at TS Warm-Up.
What we're looking for this week is Johnny Stalkers. John Stalkers, this is off the top of my head, just places where you regularly see footballers. Because a lot of people want to meet a footballer, just regularly.
Also board games. Footballers and board games, because this fella signed for Man United, Janicek.
Go on, you've got me where you want me. Bring me home. Yeah. Come on.
And Janicek, that would be a massive score in Scrabble. You couldn't have it because you couldn't have two J's.
Yeah.
But you got a K, you got a Z, you got two J's. You're looking at a 50.
You're clean up.
Hang on, wait a second. Is there only one J in a travel cert?
Only one J, there's one K.
It's worth eight, isn't it? It's worth eight, isn't it?
Yeah, and then you've got your.
The tweets about the brass band that follow England have been amazing.
We've had a real result.
And we've got lots of work to do to stop them going to Rio.
Well, that's the next step, isn't it?
Hang on a minute. Rio, the Rio brass and all that, they're not going to get anywhere. They're going to be out brass.
But they'll be there.
Out brass and
out. Can you imagine taking your seat at an England game and then they file in front of you?
Listen, but
that's a good point, because when you're at a game and the opposition fans are doing all that, come on, then it's acceptable that you're abusive towards them. Yeah. But when you're at a game and there's a total, utter person
next to you. Because I think a lot of that feel that round me at the bridge.
But when somebody on your own team,
yeah,
somebody supports you, your own team is next to you and he's annoying you.
I know, but I am that sort of James a little bit. Don't get
Don't
send me in the vortex, James. Do you know what? Enough of our yakking. Here's the podcast. Morning, welcome to the warm-up with me, Johnny Vaughan, on the day when the Premier League returns and Liverpool could go top if they get a result at Newcastle. Gus Poyet's first game as Sunderland boss is away at Swansea. I was just looking actually on the telly earlier being interviewed, and you just look in those eyes, I don't know, he's got that Latin thing. I can just imagine him turning up the car battery as the terminals are placed on someone's nipples. Anyway, no news if the players will be allowed to sing before kickoff. We'll be following that in the Poyet story. And it's revealed Ian Holloway lets his wife travel on the Crystal Palace team coach. Given their recent form, it may not be too long before she actually gets a game. Warming up alongside me, the Printrepreneur James Brown, and the man with the definitive word on referees, Vinny Woods, ladies and gentlemen, the Woodman, Gavin Woods. Hello, lads.
Morning, Johnny.
Morning, Johnny.
Morning, lads. How are you?
Very well.
You know, every week I start this show like when you've got to be serious when the teacher comes in and you can't stop laughing.
But what, you get the opposite with
like,
me, do you?
Yeah, but like, no, it's not you, not you, John, it's public. Cool. The public are like the teacher coming in.
Like,
yeah.
Bob. Hey, listen,
before
we go on, I've got to just apologise to Bob Ballard. In the last couple of weeks I've been joking about him being a troll on the internet.
Yeah, we need to leave him alone, don't we?
He's bought you a chocolate bar.
Oh, look at that.
No, you've bought that and written it.
He has.
Wow, James, James Brown has written one of the most offensively violent, psychotic messages on a Kit Kat and said it's from Bob. Can I say that?
James, you're just stirring now.
Can I apologise unreservedly to Bob? The only reason I joke about it is because if you met him, he could not possibly, he's got a bad bone in his body, he couldn't possibly be that sweet man.
What I will say about Bob Ballard is he has got the best sports jumper on this radio station.
But would you just let me finish the apology for God's sake, James?
I'm apologising. Your apology's not making it.
It is.
It sounds sarcastic.
It's not sounding sarcastic. I say, if you meet Bob, you could be a friendly man. And the reason I say about the... Shut up, James. The reason I say it, oh, God, you're such a pathetic individual. And that's why it's the juxtaposition of his warmth and friendliness with what I'm saying that makes the joke. Bob doesn't like it.
It's like calling a very tall man to...
Yeah, exactly.
It's like keep digging, boys.
Yeah.
Southampton at Man United today.
I will get this apology. Anyway, sorry, Bob, you're the best. Okay, James, what are you going to say?
So you know what? In the last week, a story we missed because of all the excitement about England is what's going on at Cardiff. Cardiff, stop holding up that Kit Kat. Cardiff of the owner of Cardiff has released
broadcast.
Released probably the most important person at the club after the manager. And that's a guy called Ian Moody, who's the head of recruitment there, what we used to call scouts.
Keep it engaging, James.
And he's replaced him with a mate of his son's, who in the summer was painting the stadium. No. It's madness. And I was reading about this yesterday in The Guardian. But earlier in the week, The Guardian had a piece, a very good piece, about the rise of Exeter. Not the rise, but expectations. Exeter have got the longest-serving manager. The fans own them. Mm. And it's made me realise, actually, poor people are better at running football clubs than rich people.
Why?
Because
they have to be
rich
careful
people
with their money.
Are mental.
Yeah. Okay, say why you're completely wrong.
I'm not completely wrong.
Let me just tell you why, okay? It's rabble theory. Because...
The tyranny of the mob.
No.
So what you're saying is you're against our listeners.
No, I'm not, because they're not the rabble. They're the elite. They're sports ruling elite. They're rich in knowledge. What I'm saying to you is that I think, particularly at Chelsea, when the crowd are baying for something, I think Abramovich and the lads are sitting there thinking, right, we'll do exactly the opposite, because they're the rabble. If they knew anything, they'd be sitting where we're
sitting. I'm not talking about the fans.
Yeah.
I'm talking about when, like at Swansea, when fans come together to take over the club. I don't mean
always get it wrong. It's
they
always
don't
a disaster.
Always get it wrong.
No, let the leaders lead.
They do not all get it wrong.
You mean owners
Manchester United
really
are £600 million in debt.
Yes. Mortgage the, yeah, yeah.
Chelsea,
mortgage the club.
Where did that money come from Abramovich? What's he doing?
Genius. It came from pure genius.
Yeah.
Okay, James, back off a second. I'm going to talk to the Woodman. Woodman, what's been your big story?
My big moment
James
of the
doesn't
week.
Seem to have one.
I know. My big moment of the week was Roy Keane scared his beard off his face.
I know. Do you think we affected it?
Yeah, definitely. There was a lot of people tweeting saying, you got his beard off.
I don't think he shaved it. I think he just stood in the mirror and told it to get lost.
Really?
I think so, yeah, and it's just gone now.
Hang on, wait a second. Are we going with Chuck Norris humour for Roy Keane?
Well, Chuck Norris jokes work for Roy Keane, don't they?
Yeah, they really do. Every single Chuck Norris gag you can do, you can just put Roy Keane's name in there and they work. Gav, listen to
examples. I've got a couple here. You've got Roy Keane doesn't dial the wrong number. You pick up the wrong phone. Roy Keane doesn't sleep, he waits.
No, Roy Keane doesn't read, he stares words out.
That's right. Death once had a near Roy Keane experience. Roy Keane can slam a revolving door.
Please do tweet us with any of your...
Any other ideas, yeah.
Any other Roy Keane. But Roy, I think you look so much better without the beard.
He does, yeah.
I'd like to see Roy v. Bob.
Oh dear!
In the jumper off.
Stop stirring, James.
Because you're already on a yellow.
He is.
I'm not being funny. Gav, what are you warming up for today?
Warming up. Well, looking forward to some of the games this weekend because we've got more Premier League football, haven't we?
Oh man,
can't wait!
Isn't it nice?
It is
to actually have. I was just saying to Georgie and Mickey, you know, when I come up and do the bit before the show as the show leader. And I was just thinking how amazing it is to actually have a load of games on a Saturday. What it means is, it means even the Sunday papers will have more meaning.
Yeah, you know? Can really read them. Yeah,
you can actually get, and you're not thinking, yeah, but the play. It's honestly, we won't really have a proper table till like Wednesday when everyone's playing.
You know what? That's a good point because those of us over 30, 40, 50, or your case, Johnny, we know that football traditionally started at 3 o'clock, apart from Tranmere. 3 o'clock on a Saturday, Tranmere started at 7:30 on Friday night. Whatever. My little boy was going off to see Arsenal today and he said, his mum said, what time does it start? And he said, 2:30, 4:30, something like that.
And he never knew about the standard.
No, because he's got no concept at 3 o'clock, because he's 12.
Yeah. Yeah.
3 o'clock is
when kickoff
time.
When God meant man to play
football. It's in the commandments.
Well, because they used to shut the pubs in the afternoon.
Right.
So it was just to fill the gap.
We have to thank the Polish fans on Tuesday night for drowning out the England band.
Yes.
Thank you, Poland. They made such a good noise, and they made the most beautiful noise you can hear at a football match, which is a crowd making loads of noise.
Yes.
Not a band.
Yes.
Not a brass band, especially.
And we didn't hear...
Yeah.
They're not even a brass band, are they?
Oh, exactly.
They're just like
did you know Bernie?
A few blokes with some...
They're the brass that should be banned.
Did you know Bernie Clifton?
Ban the band!
Did you know Bernie Clifton is in that band?
No, he's not.
Yes,
he's not.
He is. Ostrich comedian Bernie Clifton is in that
band. No, they're from Sheffield Wednesday.
Yes, they are, but he's joined since. There's a few of them.
As in Samuel Tweet.
Variety seaside act Bernie Clifton.
He really knows how to time a career move, doesn't he?
Yeah.
I know, but I've been doing panto in Heckmondwike for 17 years. I'll join that band everyone hates.
James, what are you warming up for today?
Well, I'm asking people today on the show to have you ever interrupted a footballer or a sportsman?
Interrupted them?
Have you ever interrupted them? Because it never ends well.
Don't be shy. Join the proceedings by calling the show on 08717 223344. Email us via talksport.com. Or you can tweet us at DSWarmup or text us at 81089. 50 people has normal sending charges of blood.
New to us, he's a smooth operator.
Good morning to John Gregory. John, are you there?
Good morning. I'm not so sure I can live up to that bit.
Come on.
Nice bit of music.
How are you, John? I haven't seen you for ages.
No, it's been a while. Actually, last time I saw you, John, I think you had hair.
Wow, that's going back. But I think last time I saw you, though, I was still admiring yours. You really do have one of sport's best thatches.
It's the most enduring haircut.
It's extraordinary.
It is.
I actually, on my father's deathbed, I kissed my father. seriously, he was 69 years old. I kissed my father, and I looked at this great head of hair that he had, and I can remember saying to him, thank you for passing this.
Thank you for my hair.
Absolutely.
Well, your hair, I mean, I've looked at it. When I used to interview you from time to time, I was so distracted by it. You're like a chinchilla up there. You can't actually get through and see any scalp.
No, it's like Mikel Arteta's hair. It's perfect.
Once you gaze into John Gregory's hair, you ain't coming back.
The thing is, you're always looking for the grey hairs, aren't you? That's what you're really doing.
We have a saying in my house, John. If it's grey, it's going to stay.
Yeah.
Exactly.
If it's not going grey on top of the sides, that's where it's staying. Okay, John, let's get into this. During your playing days, what were your pre-match preparations?
Well, obviously, I sort of I played over a period of 20 years, and things did start to change in the last 3 or 4 years that I played. We never used to have warm-ups, Johnny, so... You know,
No one even stretching in the dressing room.
Well, yeah, there was a bit of that. There was a bit of stretching. And then literally, you know, the gaffer sort of said, right then, lads, off you go. You put the fag out and whack the shorts on. And literally, that's what it was.
What do you mean you were smoking naked? Everyone was just smoking there with no shorts on, just everything flopping out with a fag on. And then you put the fag out and put your shorts on.
Literally, and then the captain just said, come on then, lads, let's go. I mean, it was like that at first.
How marvellous. But I tell you, also, John, back then, it was... You got... I think that sort of shows because... Back then, it was a golden age of the hamstring injury. You don't really hear so many people are out with a hamstring injury. Now it's much more complicated things.
It involves bones now.
It's bones.
They get rested when they're in the red zone.
Yeah. Anyway, John,
what did you used to eat?
We always had steak, believe it or not.
The player's lunch?
Yeah, player's lunch was a steak. Hopefully with a bit of fat on the outside of it.
Excellent. John, you've said that, just a showboat, your old school.
A bit of gristle.
We used to inject ourselves with pure cholesterol.
Speaking of meat, John, I know when you were a kid, you used to hammer the hell out of a ball against Mr. Veal's Wall. Is that right? In St. Neots.
Yes, absolutely right. He's
still moaning about it, John. But did you ever do that? Do you ever kick a ball about now, even now, against a wall?
No, I have to say I've grown out of that. I have to say.
Thanks for cul-de-sacking that
used to,
one.
No, I used to love that. That's a proper footballing wall-up, booting a ball against a wall.
Against a wall because sometimes you didn't have no one else to play with. If you were on your jack, I mean, that was the only thing you did.
We were going really nicely there about preparation. You had to just get in an obscure reference because someone's texted you about a wall. Anyway.
Mr. Veal, mate. Mr. Veal.
Don't dig yourself in, mate.
This is his neighbour.
James, it's all right, mate.
This is his neighbour whose life he ruined with
James,
a football.
It's all right. We've got to get on with the job.
Anyway, go on, John.
Okay. Under your leadership... What would a player be allowed to get away with in terms of their pre-match food?
Absolutely anything, because, you know, you're dealing with highly strung superstars.
Yeah.
Who, if they want chips, let them have chips. Not saying that many of them did, but occasionally they want to have something different. One player would want a Dover sole, someone else would want chicken, and somebody else wanted lasagna.
Right, so you've got a real a la carte scene going on there.
Absolutely.
What time would they eat this, John? Because I always wondered this before I play. What time is the latest you can eat?
It would normally be 3 hours. 3 hours before kickoff.
You've got to finish the meal with 3 hours to spare.
What about you, James? What's yours? How often do you stop eating before you play, James?
I often leave wrappers on the pitch.
Still eating.
I've heard you actually, as you're stretching out, you got pasty in your hand. Did you have any strict rules then, which had to be obeyed when you were in charge of a club? We heard Paolo Di Canio's incredibly tight regime.
No ketchup.
He had there no ketchup, no singing. Did you ever lay down any rules like that?
That worked, didn't it?
Yeah. I've got a question for you.
I think what we did, used to say, whatever they wanted to do, if they wanted to catch up after the stuff, whatever put them in the right frame of mind, because, as I said, you're dealing with highly strung superstars. If something's not quite right for them on a match day, it puts their whole body out of sync, and mentally it really upsets them. They don't go out there in the right frame of mind. I didn't play very well today because the gaffer wouldn't let me have tomato sauce before the game. That could be used as an excuse, and it will be used as an excuse if that particular player didn't play.
So they just blame the manager. They say, "Well, the manager messed with my head before the game."
What I want to know is, John, you were the last Premiership manager to field an All England 11, weren't you? I don't know if you know. Aston Villa. When the foreign players came in, did their dietary requirements upset the apple cart a bit? Were they like 10 steak and chips, one curry?
No, you'll find that all the European players, they do things slightly different in their own preparation physically, but not with food and that. It's normally the same. I'll tell you one thing is slightly different. You would encourage, especially the Spanish boys used to like to have a glass of wine on a Friday night.
Right. Good idea.
Yeah.
Which is normal for them. They've grown up like that. They're not drinkers.
But they just have a glass, don't they?
Yeah. Yeah. But I think that's a very different thing, isn't it, than sort of...
Three bottles of wine.
Three bottles of wine, yeah. A glass of wine, they say that's good for your health. That's not going to affect them. John, I'm just going to move on a little bit here. We've had so many tweets and texts and people wanting to know about the difference between managing Israel and Kazakhstan.
In those countries.
Yeah, what was the difference there, Bob? We've had so many people want to know culturally what separates those two countries.
There's a certain lack of professionalism. Certainly, when I went to Kazakhstan, it was slightly different. It's almost like something to do at the weekend, as opposed to their whole life revolves around being a footballer.
I think in that sense they've got it in perspective.
There's not too many Kazakhstan players that will actually go out of that country.
What about colourful chairman you've encountered?
Oh, Bernie Eccleston, yeah.
Yeah, you've had Jim Gregory.
Jim was fantastic.
Was he the man?
Jim was the man. I mean, seriously, in those days, if I wanted a new deal, I used to go and see Jim. I used to go and see the chairman. Instead of seeing the manager, I used to go and sit with Jim. And he used to open the champagne. He'd get the champagne bottle out and we'd have a chat. And then he'd offer me £1 a week, you know.
Nice. Good deal. Listen, John.
He was fantastic, though, for QPR. Absolutely brilliant chairman.
Gavin!
Yes.
The Woodman, Vinnie Woods.
Yeah, boy.
What's been happening in the world of refereeing this week? Firstly, let's talk about the ghost goal.
Last night, yeah. I watched it online. It's Leverkusen won 2-1 last night. They went to the top of the table.
Yeah.
With a goal that wasn't. It went to the keeper's right into the side netting and then snuck in through a hole. In the corner of the net.
Is that mad?
It snuck in through. It was the weirdest goal I've ever
Great
seen.
Great things to do before the game. But cutting little holes.
Yeah, but nets have loads of holes.
No, but this is the ball size.
A big enough hole for a ball.
No, but who can blame them?
It's mad. The Hoffenheim coach, Marcus Gisdol, said, I think we will play this game again. I don't know if they'll let them play it again.
Yeah, they will, because Bayern Munich had a game they had to replay.
Correct. Well, Rudi Völler, Leverkusen's sporting director, said, we're so embarrassed that the goal was given, but we can't be held responsible. Hoffenheim have spent a lot of money on a nice stadium. Maybe next time they should buy some proper nets.
It's a bit cruel. Yeah. No, but it's very German, isn't it?
It is.
Maybe next time they should buy some proper nets.
Some proper nets.
It's a good name, isn't it? Hoffenheim.
Yeah.
It's a lovely name, James. It's a lovely name.
Hoffenheim.
Well done, James. Making some great...
That was just that one.
Yeah, go on. Gav, next up, what games are you looking forward to this week?
Well, we're looking at Lee Probert. He's got the Arsenal-Norwich game at 3 o'clock. He has awarded way fewer cards per free kick. He issues a yellow card for every 31 and a half free kicks.
You're kidding me.
But that's loads. I mean, the other refs... Anthony Taylor's got Chelsea Cardiff.
Yeah.
He's given 17 yellows and one red. The Everton Hull game has got Neil Swarbrick. He's given 11 yellows, no reds. Mike Jones, he's got the United Man United versus Southampton game,
yeah.
has done four yellows and one red.
Yeah.
And Howard Webb has done 15 yellows. When you get to Lee Probert, he's done two yellows.
Wow!
In his four games and one red. So that's,
so he really, he's
he doesn't like, yeah, he just
he's
won't.
Got very weak arms.
No, no, it's not that, James. What he is, what he's done is, he's saying, come on, it's a man's game.
Yeah, just play
I,
on.
I love it when
yeah,
a referee's...
that's a brilliant attitude.
It is.
It is.
Come on!
No, because you genuinely feel frustrated when you see a bloke oh. I saw this week.
We'll be the judge of that.
Yeah, no, obviously we can't see
no,
it. We're
on,
talking about YouTube. There's a dirt track scrambler, and he goes over a hill,
yeah.
and he flies off his bike, and he just flies for about 40 yards, and he lands in a crump. And he's a big pile of mud. And he just gets up and gets on his bike. And the, and somebody's that gone, is, footballers, take note. And then they shot Rivaldo falling over. At
well,
the
I'd like it if they went for a bit more of what I call Hatton syndrome. When Ricky Hatton fought Floyd Mayweather, and he said afterwards, it's not a tickling contest. and I think that's exactly right. I'd like referees to have a bit more of that attitude. It's not a tickling contest
absolutely,
out there. It's a physical game. I mean, in the early days of football, remember when they sat down in 1863 to codify football at Cambridge University, one of the big points was, should we allow people to kick each other when they haven't got the ball? And it was they just decided, no, you've got to take the ball first before you try and hit the man as hard as you can. And it was called hacking. You could just literally just go up to someone and you kick him in the shins as hard as possible. Mm. And it was considered a really good test of manliness.
The best tackle I ever saw, Pat Vandenhoutt running 20 yards, Stuart Pearce running 20 yards.
50,
it was like
50.
A standoff.
Yeah.
And they both were... It was almost like in slow-mo. Big thighs. And they hit the ball at the same time.
Oh, that must have hurt.
It was brilliant. And the commentator said, that's a tackle. That's what he said. And he went, that's a tackle.
Have you met Stuart Pearce?
Yes, I have met Stuart Pearce.
I've sunbathed next to him, yeah?
I bet that was disappointing
was,
for you.
It was weird. It was at La Manga in Spain. And I've sunbathed next to him. And because I'm quite thin, I was sort of sunbathing. It was on the next door lounger. And I couldn't help just looking at those famous thighs and doing a thigh-to-thigh comparison. I realised there's about three of mine for one of his.
Really?
Yeah, I just kept my eyes. I mean, you know, I wasn't, you know, being too full on. But I tell you something, when Stuart arrives anywhere, everyone sort of gets serious.
It's because like, he's so serious.
Because he's so manly. And wherever he arrives, it's a bit sort of...
Oh, here we go, yeah.
It's just, it's not, I'm not saying it's a downer.
You're not doing the England banter.
But suddenly, put away all your childish banter, lads. We've got a man up here.
You know
get
what,
on with this.
Johnny, you are onto a really good point about football there, in that, you know, when you see somebody fly in and just take somebody out in a nasty way,
that's
not,
did.
No, but it's good. But when you used to see somebody fly in
yes.
for a really full-on yes. challenge and hit the ball,
yes.
and they got a bit of the bloke that's as well, but the other
tackle.
Bloke didn't mind.
Yeah.
If you do watch these, sometimes ESPN show these old Match of the 70s,
yeah.
and you'll see Norman Hunter and Archie Gemmell.
Yeah.
It's like car crashes.
I know.
You know, Larry Lloyd will just like run over a bloke.
Extreme football tackles. The early kickoff today is at 12:45, Newcastle versus Liverpool, and Graham Kearney, the Roger Moore of Talk... Graham Kearney, the Roger Moore of TalkSport, he has the teams.
I've had a suntan all my life.
I certainly do. There we go. I tell you what, I remember years ago, talking about footballers and things like that, where you do see them. I was covering in this neck of the woods a snooker tournament, and I saw Gazza walking into the snooker tournament. At the same time, coming through the other door was Steve Davis, and Gazza bellowed across the hall, "Oh, Stevie! 180!
What a dark score.
That was it. So, that is a true story.
Clap it in, because it's a beautiful thing.
It was a classic, it really was.
That was the podcast this week. Hope you enjoyed the warm-up. I thought it was a cracker this week. Once
it
we calmed James down, it's fantastic.
It was great.
I can't wait for you to be let out
I'm
next
holding
week.
My hand up to you now like Richie Beno.
You certainly don't.
It was
don't.
A
that was
you were worried. You were worried about what you said about Paul Daniels. You want to have a listen back to what you said about Richie Beno?
Well, Richie, no, because he is a nicotine-stained face, like a nicotine-stained waxwork. But I tell you what, I apologise also to Willie Carson. It's just that laugh when he's in a top hat. It is quite
scary.
Ghoulish. It is very, very scary. He could. You wouldn't want to go trick-or-treating with Willie. Anyway, we'll speak to you next week. Welcome to your warm-up podcast. I'm Johnny Vaughan.
I'm Gavin Woods.
I'm James Brown.
Good. That was really good, lads. We've never done that before.
That was tight.
It was really nice. It was tight. Mm. Why are we all wearing headphones?
There's no need, is there?
Why do you wear headphones?
It's to hone your mic craft.
Is it?
Yeah, because you can hear what the mic's doing as you move in and out.
Oh, you're absolutely right. All hit radio coming at you.
That's because he's an engineer.
Well, no, bass actually, it's exponential for every inch you move close to the microphone, James. It's an interesting fact about microphone technology. James, good week for you this week, even though you're a bit ill.
I'm not well at all. I've been eating dry toast all the way through the show.
And four fried chickens.
Yeah.
Not four fried chickens.
And a Coke.
Oh, you know what? When that lady said she had her chickens on the coach, I was down to be rude. I've really behaved myself.
You really reined it in. And do you know what? It was a better show for that.
Very
even
tiny.
Though I felt... you and Gav coming up with that thing, the wench on the bench, I felt that was a little bit sexist.
Close to the line.
I thought Gavin went too far with that.
Oh, God.
Well, no, I just think what you did was...
I can't win.
I think is that later, James, you try to recover. What happened was we have the bench who enter our predictions round at the end of each warm-up every week. And this week, James referred to Mel as the wench on the bench. After Gavin influenced him by thinking it up, James couldn't resist blurting it out. But then afterwards, James decided to style it out by going, because actually, you'll meet a lot of women these days. You know more about football than blokes. I've met loads of women that know more about football.
No, I was simply pointing out
than
that
actual men at Leeds
that's
United.
Not actually true.
He might as well have what sent was, her a bottle of champagne.
What I was saying was, it's the only time
Rose
on the
for the ladies, sir.
It's the only time on the show when anyone actually sits in the studio who knows what the hell is going on at any clubs.
That woman last week was talking about Simon Grayson
and changing
stop
his
trying to embrace. She's not going to complain, James. You're all right.
What did we talk about this week?
Well, we talked about Alex Ferguson, first of all, who is fantastic because he said...
he's throwing grenades everywhere.
As a football man, we've got to have a long think about that one.
He said Steven Gerrard wasn't all that. And
yeah, but that's because he didn't sign him.
Exactly. He's got a bitterness. But I remember him saying that the lad wouldn't it gum because he wanted to sign him. But I can't wait for Stevie G's autobiography after that.
Do you know something? All your life, that's what you have to do. A friend of mine told me this. It's one of the best bits of advice ever. If you're in any doubt about anything, just think, what would Stevie G do? I'm being absolutely serious. If you think about buying something in a shop or you think about approaching a certain female...
What would Stevie do?
Getting a hotel room, what would Stevie G do?
Mr. Liverpool.
What would Stevie G do? That's all you got to think. And you won't go far wrong.
No. Does he say anything about Becker, about Shearer in his book?
I don't think
because Shearer turned him down as well.
Did he?
Really?
He's got a latent bitterness about anybody who's crossed him, which is quite surprising for somebody who's been so successful.
And he doesn't seem to mind if it's a bit of a problem at United now to talk about players that are still there.
That's fantastic. No, but he's just playing mind games on behalf of David Moyes, isn't he? That's why he's insulting Gerrard.
He's taking the attention away.
Actually, that's not a bad thing. He may well be saying
that's all he's doing, of course. That's why he's brought out the autobiography. He doesn't need to.
Beckham is
bigger than Ferguson. He doesn't need the cash. No, that's true.
Beckham is a lot bigger than Ferguson.
Do you know something? As well as fantasising about being a Nigerian diplomat, my other one is managing is to manage an East European side. I'll be a billionaire in a week. Here's your podcast. Good morning, welcome to the warm-up with me, Johnny Vaughan, on the day when 150 years ago three men met in a pub and drew up the rules which still form the backbone of football. Big anniversary. The Pope is pictured with a Sunderland shirt. They'll need all the support they can get ahead of their game against Newcastle tomorrow. That's Sunderland, not the Roman Catholic Church. That match live on TalkSport from 1 o'clock. It'd be odd if Newcastle had that fixture. And Chaz and Dave have issued a come and get me to the FA to record the official England World Cup song. The England band go out one door. And in the other one,
not
Shry,
yet.
Chas and Dave.
Not yet, Johnny. Our work is not done.
No, it's not. Warming up alongside me, that was the voice of one half of them. Ladies and gentlemen, giving you the definitive word on referees every week. Vinnie Woods, the Woodman. Gavin Woods.
Morning, Johnny.
And next door to morning, Gav. Next door to him, printrepreneur James Brown. Morning,
morning,
James.
Morning, Johnny. How are you?
Yeah, good. Yeah, good. Chas and Dave, then.
Yeah,
you've got a theory about their educational background.
No, I've met them, and they call each other Charles and David when you're with them. Charles, I think, went to Harrow, and David was to eat there. He's an older Tony.
Yeah. Man.
And before they go on, they go, right, let's put on the old Cockney act then. Give me a landing, go every time. Time.
Time.
If you're in your car, just enjoy doing that. If you're on your own, just going, time. Made up my mind.
What you're saying is they're actually really posh.
They are really, both of them public school.
Chaz and Dave. Yeah, like Bob Hoskins.
Hello, Charles. Hello, David. Right. Let's get into character. I'm kidding.
Bob Hoskins was the same. He was from posh Peter Hampstead, couldn't get any work, so he decided to talk like Michael Caine.
I know, if you meet Bob in real life, you're absolutely right. He's like, hello there, how you doing? Very good, very good.
And
he's quite gruff.
Prince Philip is actually opposite. He's actually from Rotherham.
Is he? Well, do you know, the weird thing is, though, you say that about Prince Philip, but and the northern accent, but when you hear Prince Philip say the word yes... Yeah. He does pronounce it exactly as a northerner says the word for your ears.
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 I had this
thing. Ears. The more broadly you actually say the word ears, the more Yorkshire it sounds. Actually, the more you get close to the Duke of Edinburgh. Hence, ears.
That's the same as when a very strong Cockney accent says the word flakes.
It sounds athletics.
It sounds exactly like athletics.
Yeah.
Flakes.
Now you have to
He's
say
going
flakes.
Out get a
posh. You have to say it posh.
Yeah.
Flakes.
Bob's your man for athletics.
Yes.
You have to ask him if he ever pronounces it.
Yes. How's your week been, James?
Yeah, well, it's been very difficult to get away from Fergie.
Awesome.
But I was reading that because the publishers didn't do one deal with one newspaper, everybody's at it. So you don't really need to buy Fergie's book.
You don't know.
You can just read the papers every single day. There's another row.
Throwing grenades everywhere, isn't he?
It's disappointing, I think, because... Years ago, I had this album on Cherry Red Records. It's called Shankly Speaks. Obviously, I'm not a Liverpool fan, but listening to 90 minutes of interview with Bill Shankly, and all he did was just enthuse about football in his sort of honey-like Scottish accent, which I'm sure you boys could do. It was just amazing. I mean, as a Leeds fan, he was enthusing about the great Don Revy team. Leave it. And
let's not talk about them.
But this is the exact opposite. 30 years on, you sort of think, does he need to do this? And this is what Roy Keane, who we take the mickey out of, does... he was saying that this week, really.
He's
and actually, suddenly,
unnecessary,
suddenly the devil had the high ground saying with his mad eyes, does he really need to do this?
Yeah, do you know what, though? He questioned Roy Keane's commitment. No, what I'm saying is, that's like questioning a kamikaze pilot. Just as he padlocks himself into the cockpit, saying, you call that commitment? You call that...
you got your seatbelt on?
What I would like to have... Yeah, look at you in your seatbelt. Yeah. But you know what? I would like to see... I don't know, just Roy versus Fergie in a stare-off. Live.
I thought a Roy Keane stare-out could be a punishment instead of a prison sentence.
Well, he mentioned that
as a punishment. You just got to sit in a room with Roy and he just stares at you.
He just gives you a look.
Terrifying.
Yeah.
But did you see when there was a match on live in the week and Ian Wright and Roy were commenting on it? And Wright is absolutely breaking down with laughter. Because clearly... Roy's putting on a very public face. It would have been amazing to see what he really thought.
What his real eyes would have looked like.
No, I'm not bothered, really. I'm not bothered. This is his opinion. It doesn't bother me. But the other fellas he slagged off. I feel sorry for them.
I feel sorry for them. I can take it.
I'm like a landmine.
The other thing is that Sir Alex said that he commented about Beckham and said, David thought he was bigger than me. And I think, you know what, globally... I don't know, but do you know what?
He is.
Well,
wouldn't it be great, though, to have Fergie doing adverts for underwear?
Oh, yeah.
Fergie. No, Fergie posing for just the old school jockey brief, just standing there with, when it used to say, wise guy. Just Fergie on an advertising hoardie in Times Square, just standing there, getting a can out the fridge late at night, just with his butt cheek there, just a pair of jockey wise. Or Dolce & Gabbana.
It's Fergie, an elegant image.
Fergie lying down the side of a bus, just in...
Just
in a tartan jockey wife.
Tartan jockeys.
Lundberg with the Calvins.
Oh, yeah, with the Calvins,
But much better to go for the Grey Pound, right? And get... Also, Fergie... What would Fergie's aftershave actually smell like if he bought out Fergie?
Vinegar from a fish and chip shop?
Okay, hint of vinegar. We can build up the sense.
A shipbuilder's welder's... sock.
Okay, a shipbuilder. I think it was a
shipbuilding
bit, welder's
sock.
I think the tang
sock.
Of chewing gum in there as well.
Spearmint vinegar.
Yes. Spearmint. That sounds like a really, really low rent sort of lap dancing club. Spearmint vinegar. Right by a chippy. Anyway, Gav, what are you warming up for today, matey?
Oh, the big game, Chelsea City.
That's tomorrow.
It is tomorrow, yeah.
Okay, what are you not warming up for Palace Arsenal, which you've got at 12:45
today?
Well,
I am, but I don't like to keep talking about Arsenal because I'm an Arsenal fan and people will get annoyed with it.
Well, I gather you and James had a little trip midweek, didn't you?
We did, yeah. We went to the Dortmund game.
We had a bit of a date.
We had a bit of a date.
Got soaked. James got sick.
What's that about? We had three tickets, so it was me, him and Bob went.
Yeah.
You took Bob Ballard?
Yeah.
No.
Did you? Because you sent me a text saying that.
We just wanted it to be a nice night out without any trouble.
Without any bad feelings.
What, you strengthening ties? Was you strengthening ties? Was that what it was? Sort of...
We're creating alliances.
Was it?
No.
Was it a tie strengthening tour?
Actually, it was an exercise in getting wet.
Okay. Well, not a good night for you, though. Mm-mm. Not a good night there at all, Gav.
Actually, you know what?
No.
Incidentally, you're about 7 weeks into your media career, Gav. Do you know what I like?
Already drinking tea.
No, you're already sipping tea on it. You know, I love it. I feel that relaxed for enough.
I'm enjoying it while it's still hot.
I can go, yeah.
You know what?
Even on it.
I'm not going to let the show get in the way of my muggery.
Team, you know, Gav just said, are we always banging on about the same teams? A team that we have not mentioned at all this year who are doing really well are Hull.
Yeah.
And Huddleston, Tom Huddleston, who they bought from Spurs, has said if he scores today against Spurs, he's going to cut his afro off.
Wow.
Because
wow.
He's been growing his afro whilst he's been on the goal track.
Have we got Ray Parra up there?
Yeah.
We want live coverage of that one.
I did that when Leeds got relegated into the Championship. I thought, right, I'm not going to shave.
Mm.
By the time we're in the bottom, we'd been relegated. I look like, again, we'd gone down a league one. I look like Dave Lee Travis.
You look like Saddam Hussein
really
in the drain.
Hair is a really bad thing to set your marker by. You end up looking like a outdated DJ. Yeah. Huddleston's just going to end up like the Hair Bear Bunch.
Thanks. Where'd you reach that sort of random analogy from? How can you just pluck that one out of the air? Actually, do you know what? I've got my hair alike on today. Gary McAllister's our guest. He'll be coming up later.
Yep.
He's someone that gives me a sneak preview. He's like the event, my hair event horizon.
A few years ahead.
But he looks all right because I think that as well. I've got loads of hair, but it's just edging back. So I think sooner or later I'm going to have to do a Gary Mack. I'm going to have to go short back and size, but with the tuft.
I know, so I've got the island at the top of the head.
By the way, he was a great player. It's great to have him on.
He was a great player.
Liverpool and Leeds. Yeah.
I was watching him yesterday on YouTube. He's so skillful.
That's a great player.
Can I say the last thing before we throw to a break here? That Fergie quote, please use it all the time. And I've been using it all morning.
As a football man.
As a football man, I had to think about where we were going. As a football man. Honestly, it's so handy.
To define what a football man is, don't we?
I will do that after the break.
Okay, James is going to talk, because you've actually had a proper definition of what a football man is.
From a proper footballer.
Yeah.
But do send in any of your tweets about, as a football man, what have you decided to do? As a football man, I decided to get on the pub for 6 hours.
Exactly.
Anything you want. The other thing from Fergie's book, which I loved, was just that lovely quote, Wenger's fists were clenched. Is there anything less threatening in football
than Wenger?
Than Wenger.
I remember him and Pardew having a little push and shove at one point in the game. Yeah.
But it's just handbags at this stage.
It was handbags, yeah.
Anyway, this is the warm-up. This is the only show where you can really enjoy beer, wings, sports. We've got Gary McAllister coming right up for you. We've got the Woodman giving you Back in Black. We've got more James Brown. We've got Bristol City in a minute. It's all coming up on the show. Stay with us. Get involved by calling the warm-up with Johnny Vaughan on 08717-22-3344 or email us via talksport.com. You can tweet us at TS Warm-Up or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply. Hello there. You listen to the warm-up on TalkSport. Thanks to Capital One, the credit card that supports the supporters, as indeed we like to think we do on the show. We're all about you guys out there on the road, journeying to games, serving up the perfect.
Speaking as football men.
Yeah, that's speaking as football men.
Well,
on the subject of which, I promised you that James Brown would reveal to you what Eddie Gray told him was the definition of a football man.
Well, for a while now, people who want to let you know that they know more about football than you do.
As a football man, I want to know this definition, yeah. James. Crack in.
No, but managers say, as a football man, I know more than you.
Yeah.
No, it's not used that often, but go on.
Big Sam, people like that are always using it. Anyway, so I asked Eddie Gray, I said, Eddie, is there actually a real difference? What would you say is the difference between a fan and a football man, i.e. somebody who's played or managed it?
Go on.
Because I don't think there is any.
Go on. What do you
think? And he said, when a goal is scored against your team, a fan will look at the last person who could possibly have done something, like the goalkeeper or the defender who wasn't marking or whatever. Mm-hmm. The fan will always look at the very last person. But a football man will look
at the first.
we'll look at where the team conceded possession.
Okay, that's the definition.
That is the proper definition of a football.
What was the turning point?
Eddie Gray, the great Leeds manager and player.
That's a good definition.
The moment when the probabilities changed.
Yeah. When did we lose the ball?
Absolutely fantastic. Mm. And that's what a football man does.
That is a football man.
Do pepper your conversation with it out there if you've really got to make any excuses for anything. Or you need to just buy yourself a valuable 3 seconds before you make a feeble excuse. Believe me, you can do a lot worse than, as a football man, I felt it was just time for me to leave. Anyway, we've got Gary McAllister, I hope, who's on the line now. He is our, he's our man warming up. Here we go. Somebody go get there. Gary McAllister, good morning to you.
Good morning, Johnny. How are you?
Not too bad, Gary. Thank you very much for coming on the show. Let's just crack right in there with your warm-up. We obviously play Someone's Going to Get Their Ass Kicked. how did you used to psych up for games? What was your warm-up, Gary?
My warm-up, just during the week, preparation, who you're going to play against, your immediate opponent, the team, their style. And it was all sort of, it was just self-motivation and just so used to it from a young boy going up and preparing, and as you progress up the ladder and get to the professional game, you just did much the same things as you did as a kid.
Okay, but you'd focus on your opposition. Was it sort of like, Montgomery in his caravan at El Alamein? He always had a picture of Rommel above the desk because he knew that was his... he was focusing on that too.
His enemy.
Personal battle was against... did you do that sort of thing there, Gary? Did you have photos?
To be fair, I didn't really have pictures of Vinnie Jones and Patrick Vieira.
Come on, you can admit it. You can admit it. I love that.
But the thing was, that obviously it was horses for courses. You're going against Roy Keane, you had to have a different mentality, going against somebody like Vieira. And earlier back in my career, going against somebody like Glenn Hoddle, more of a technician.
How would your warm ups differ then? If you're taking on Roy Keane, for the afternoon, obviously you're really, that somebody's going to get their ass kicked is almost appropriate there.
Steel shin pads.
But how would your warm up differ from taking on someone like Glenn Hoddle, a glamour man?
Well, the thing is, maybe against Glenn Hoddle, you would go and try and nick the ball off Glenn Hoddle, try and steal the ball out of tackle. If you tried to do that against a Vieira or a Roy Keane, you would end up being badly hurt.
I thought you were going to say with Roy, you go to the gym and have a go on the speed bag. If you take on Glenn Hoddle, you go and have a sunbed.
Yeah.
No, the thing was, they're just totally different players. That is the thing. If you dangled a leg in front of Roy Keane, you were in trouble. That's just a fact, Gary.
That's a fact.
That's a footballing fact, Gary. When you're going out against someone like Vieira or Roy Keane, would you have turned to someone like Batts or Haaland and say, look, will you take Roy today?
Yeah.
I'm going to play football. You're going to deal with the Bulldog.
No, not necessarily. And saying that, Batty is probably one of the toughest, I've ever played with.
He was
proper. He was
Leeds,
a proper Yorkshire lad.
Because he plays for Leeds United.
Absolutely.
Leeds United's hard as nails. He's James' favourite player of all time.
Wasn't he a brilliant player?
He's one of those guys that I don't think he was totally appreciated. I think he's a footballer's footballer. He only tends to appreciate somebody when he's playing.
Footballer's footballer, there you go. Well done.
Because a lot of players are like that at Leeds.
Speaking as a football man, I know that he's a footballer's footballer.
Yeah. as a football man, I'm really impressed you picked him out.
Johnny, you wouldn't understand because the fact is you've got to play alongside him. And unfortunately, you've not been able to play alongside him. I was fortunate enough to play alongside David Batty. That's when you really understand how good he is.
Yeah, I've watched him. I've watched the carnage and how he's able to.
There's no carnage.
He was like
a surgeon. He was brilliant.
Those people, there's a big pile up and you just see one car escape and they've caused it. That was Batty. Gary, just tell us a little bit about your food preparation. Gav is our resident nutritionist. We're one of the few sports radio shows that can offer that.
this is a good point. I've got a little bug to bear here because the fact is, we all seem to tend to think that it was Arsene Wenger and the foreign invasion. They brought all this technical stuff and what we should eat. But I can remember right way back in the early 90s at Atwood United, Howard Wilkinson, you know, we went to Leeds University and they gave us all these that. And we were eating the proper stuff way back in the early night. Wasn't it brought in by any foreign coach or any foreign managers?
Nice.
To Chelsea.
We had some brains here as well.
So you say sort of pasta's a British thing.
Well, the thing was you would load up, you know, early, you know, going towards the weekend, you would be properly loading up on carbohydrate.
Yeah.
It's very simple. It's not,
and what
it's
was
not
it, what was...
eat protein after the game. And then as you go towards the next week, you know, you load up on carbohydrate.
Gary, I know you're a very focused footballer. Yeah. Did ever, was that focus ever broken before a game? We've had some very good stories from some of your predecessors in previous weeks in this slot in the show, telling us about some of the things that happened on the way to grounds. Were there any incidents that stand out that sort of ruined your pre-match preparation?
Not necessarily. There's the one that really springs to mind. It didn't necessarily ruin our preparation, my team's preparation, but the old Wimbledon team, you know, they were really, they used to be buoyed up by sort of loud music. They had the cassette in there, you know, and the tapes going. And Gordon Strachan and I once, we arrived at the ground. We got to the ground early to have pre-match. And the Wimbledon, you know, kit men had been arriving and put the cassette player in the dressing room. We nicked the men's league after that.
I tell you what, though. You and Gordon must have made the dour duo. Yeah.
I'm talking about Fashion and Joan.
Yeah.
They did not like not having the music that day. I think we won 4 or 5 nil.
Nice. Because of a dour duo from Scotland who wanted
a wee bit of
dust up on in the changing room. That's fantastic.
That's brilliant.
They went in, they nicked their music.
Not just the batteries, the men's lead that killed them.
Oh, fantastic.
You nicked them back up.
Did
batteries.
They try and take revenge in the game?
Can I say, there was a stage there where McAllister and Strachan, they took the lead, and then one of you, and I suspect it was Gordon, go, better check for batteries.
Those big giant batteries, you know those men, can you remember those?
The PP, not the PP9. It's a whopper.
Yeah, the big fella.
Yeah, that's the PP9. It's a whopping battery, that one. Okay, sorry about that. Battery
that's a classic. I like that one.
Can I say, how did warm-ups change over your time there? You were saying people, you were very healthy under Howard Wilkinson.
Yeah.
But
that
can't have gone all the way across footballers. There must have been some of the most unhealthy pre-match men you ever saw. Who is the unhealthiest footballer you ever saw?
Oh, I'm going back to my early days at Motherwell. we used to have steak and eggs before a game.
The players' lunch.
Oh,
nice. That'll do it.
You know, that was not good.
So Motherwell wasn't as sort of forward thinking as Howard Wilkinson when it came to preparation.
Well, we're talking, you know, early 80s, and that was a done thing. I think right across the board and across Britain, I think most players would be having steak and eggs before a game.
Nice, nice.
If they could afford it.
Okay, do you know what, Mr. McAllister, can I just say, as a football man, it's been an absolute pleasure to have you on the show. Yeah, lads,
fantastic.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have met Gary McAllister, the man.
Thanks, Gary.
He's joined us on the warm-up. Thank you, Gary. Cheers, matey.
All the best. Cheers.
Bye.
Bye.
I've got to say, that's the best guest we've had, just because he was such a great player.
He was a fantastic player.
I know we've had other good managers on, but yeah. Gary Mack was a brilliant player.
Imagine how focused him and Strachan were before games. Imagine how serious that... Do you know, I always imagine... Have I said this to you before about Gordon Strachan?
We should get Gordon on.
We should get Gordon on. But do you know what? I can just always, when I see him, I just always imagine him as quite a surly fishmonger who's down in London. And Jeff, you just imagine.
Really sick of getting up.
I can just imagine him not catching my eye, going, "I've got no haddock to deer torso."
Yeah, without looking.
I've got no quarter torso. Sorry. Next, please. And then being really, then very friendly with a woman called Brenda. I've got no quarter taste. So sorry. Hello, Brenda. How are you? Why is he rude to me? What have I done?
He knows you want the haddock.
Are you still here? I've said I've got no haddock. Yes, Brenda. Lovely to see you. Hello, my love. How are you? I've got some lovely texts in on the as a football man tip. Here we go.
I've got one here.
As a football man, I've decided to go to work very hungover. Only 2 hours, hopefully. That's Foley Boy in Kilmarnock. Thank you very much, Foley Boy.
I got one from Tony Haynes. As a football man, I listen to Talk Sport. From Fergie in his slippers and designer Y-fronts.
Thank you very much. I would love to. With slippers on the side of the bus.
Slippers as well.
Oh, awesome.
Pants and slippers.
No, just his dressing gown, just opened tantalisingly down one side.
Johnny, you make me feel sick.
Yeah, I'm getting queasy.
I've not been too well this week. I don't want to think about Fergie in his underpants.
Have you got any as a football man? Then,
no, but I tell you what we have got. We've got the other tweet that we're asking for today. Yeah. Is, have you ever seen a bad player have a good game?
Oh, yeah,
that's a good one.
We were talking about this in the pub after the show last week because there was Leeds played Milan in the Champions League and all our central defenders were out. And Michael Dubery, who's much loved but much pilloried, and Danny Mills, who had a sarcastic chant for him, were paired. And they had the most amazing
game. Isn't it great
game.
When it happens?
It was like a battle for master and commander. Yeah. They were like huge warships taking on the Italians, and they were fantastic.
Yeah.
Neither of them ever played that great again. So have you seen somebody who's normally not considered to be much cop?
Mm.
Bad player, good game. One. Send them in.
We'll give you the details to text, tweet and contact us on right after this one. As a football man, I've decided to have a second stag weekend in Magaluf. I got married 15 years ago.
Oh,
that's
brilliant.
Scott in Romford. Can I say, as a football man, I thoroughly improve. do you know, we're going to take a little break. We're back with more of your as a football man tweets. Details coming up of how you can get in touch with us.
Don't be shy. Join the proceedings by calling the show on 08717 22 3344. Email us via talksport.com or you can tweet us at DS Warmup or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply.
This is the Warmup. I'm Johnny Vaughan. It's 11:37. I'm joined, as always, by Gavin Woods, the Woodman, and entrepreneur James Brown. You're right there, James.
Yeah, very good.
You look like you're getting tweets coming in
getting
hot.
We're getting a lot to do with the hashtag bad player, good game. A name that keeps reoccurring is Jonathan Spector for West Ham.
Okay.
Sam Diss sent that in. We've did nothing, but then scored two goals against Man United, his old club.
Gareth Hall did this at Chelsea. Never had that good a game, yeah? Because he didn't have back legs. He had trotters. They didn't bend at the knees. They didn't bend at the knee. And he took a ball from Ruud Gullit, which in itself was one of the weirdest turnarounds in football. Yeah. When we were going through this transition period that you had
Gullit.
To Hall, you're thinking, what?
Why?
Have I just woken up from some crazy dream? And Gareth Hall struck this ball, left-hand side, just outside the area, left-hand side, banged it first time, yeah? Top corner, most beautiful goal. And do you know what he did? Rather than going mad like he thought he would, he didn't. He didn't do that at all. He played it like Thierry Henry, like, that's our role.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. Sure time. That's me. So respectful.
I can't even remember that player. Was it Gareth Hall?
I just thought the joy in his heart as he scored that. He must just think, oh, my God, I've scored a goal. But no, he just stood there, like, with one finger in the air, like, that's our role. That's the Gareth Hall who's been waiting to come out. That's me.
There's loads of these. Every club's got one. Jimmy Chore says, Seven Kenny. Champions League final, Istanbul. Complete muppet, but saves his best game ever for the final.
It's a beautiful thing. Do you know what? I hate...
Fernando Torres scored two goals this week.
Don't worry about Torres.
You've got to be specific.
I'm joking. Controversial. I'm joking. Come on, man. We're not going below the belt. Earlier on, we're talking about, as a football man, I had to think about where we were going. Our favourite Alex Ferguson quote, I've got one in here. As a football man, this has just been texted in, actually. As a football man, I finished my 12-hour night shift at 6:30 this morning, now up to play football this afternoon, then straight back to work for a 13-hour night shift as the clocks go back. Ooh. I love football and your show. Baz in Leamington Spa. As football men, Baz, we salute you.
We like
Very
that.
Good.
Gav, what do you got
I've
in?
Got one here. As a football man, it's acceptable to get the pints in for the 12:45 kickoff.
Absolutely right. As a football man, that's a good move.
As a football man, I would say that's a football man's football man.
He's a football man.
I love that when Gary Mack said, David Batty's a footballer's footballer.
He's a footballer's footballer.
That's the only stage beyond a footballing man, isn't it? A footballer's footballer.
That's real inside info.
We sense that Gary McAllister was very pro Leeds United. He remembered very fondly his time at Leeds United.
Very good.
When he won Premiership.
Gav, have you been told by him at your little outing not to do the Leeds United voice? Because normally you really celebrate this.
No.
He was too busy talking about you.
Okay, fair enough. Do you know what?
Igor Biscan versus Juventus 2005. Average player, but we wouldn't have even reached the Champions League final without him. Kieran Conway, another Liverpool fan.
It's a beautiful...
Loads of these.
Keep those coming in. Bad player, great game. Do you know what? Back in black. Back in black! Hit the slam! sorry, I can't resist it every week. It's just a little. It's my 1 minute of karaoke.
We've been too long. We're glad to be back.
Yeah. Cut loose! I fucking loose!
That's kept me hanging around.
What's the other? You got to catch me if you want me to hang! Okay, Gav. This week, Anthony Taylor. Yeah. Talk to me about it.
Well, last week he famously allowed that goal for Eto'o when he kicked the ball out of the goalie's hand, yeah, which he technically shouldn't have because you're allowed to bounce the ball without it getting taken off you by the player.
And normally, I'm always unsure over who's in it, but it's in midair.
They're allowed to bounce it.
Isn't it, if it's in the air, like when was it Nigel Jempson who headed the ball out of the goalie's hand?
Thierry Henry did it once and it was disallowed. He'd thrown the ball in the air to volley it, and Henri clipped it with his foot and went round.
But there was a Nottingham Forest player. I think it was Nigel Jempson.
It's Gary Crosby.
Was it Gary Crosby?
Yeah.
He just snuck up behind him and he headed it out of the player's hand.
Yeah,
right. He didn't have two hands on the ball.
Right. And I think Andy Dibble was the goalkeeper. That was quite controversial. I liked it. It was quite cheeky.
Yeah, I like that. George Best did as well. When the ball was being dribbled out by a goalie, went round and nicked him.
Yeah, you shouldn't do that.
Anthony Taylor last year ended up third from bottom in terms of his errors.
Did he?
Yeah, on untold referees.
Really?
Which is not great. And no. Normally, when a referee makes a big error, they get maybe put to a different lower league for a week or two, or they get, you know, made to be a fourth official or whatever it is.
They get detention. They get referee detention.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, absolutely.
This week,
very good.
This
weekend, very good.
They're at the Villa. He's refereeing the Villa Everton game, so they've got that to look forward to.
Okay. Are you starting to really look forward to games? Thinking,
oh yeah,
good. He's really under pressure.
Well, you're starting to learn more and more, aren't we?
You've got to see the guy that I sent you that stuff about. It was just he's made loads of mistakes. Last year he made loads of really big.
There's a piece
he
in
sent
the Guardian.
Two players off against Everton, didn't an Everton match?
Correct.
Famously, terrible mistakes.
He failed to award an Everton penalty at Cardiff despite Gary Medel's foul on Leighton Baines. It's as clear a penalty as you'll ever see, moaned Roberto Martinez. And,
it's a big quote, that, isn't it? It's as clear a penalty as you'll ever see. And he failed to see that.
I wonder why do you think, maybe we should get a player, ask a player, why do you think there has never been a player who has just thought, I'm going to become a top-class referee?
I don't know why. I don't know why we don't encourage them. I don't know why we don't have refereeing academies. And there's youngsters.
Imagine if Vinny was a ref. David Speedy said he was going to become a ref.
What about Roy Keane?
The bloke who spent most of his career nutting people and arguing with refs.
With the chance Speedy's going to get you.
Yeah, he's going to be the ref. Like
I'm
that
coming
ref.
To that in item three.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay. You've got an agenda.
You've got an agenda. Okay, Gav, do you want to move on from Anthony Taylor?
Yeah, let's go to item two.
Okay, item two. I'd like to talk to you about Platini, I'm not a big fan of, UEFA and racism. Because I always think, given that Sepp Blatter said some of the most outrageous things.
Unbelievably out of touch.
Not only has he proved himself to say some things that are mammothly homophobic and intolerant.
Sexist.
He's incredibly sexist. He's up there with Arnold Schwarzenegger. But do you know what? He's also, some of his, slightly racist.
He said that players should shake hands after the game, even if one of them has been racist towards the other. Just deal with it as a bit of banter. That's what his recommendation was. There's an amazing quote from this week, which we might get to later in the show. But Platini is asking why the ref did not. The new procedure, if there's monkey chanting at a game, the new procedure that UEFA recommends for a ref is to stop the game, ask the tannoy announcer to tell the crowd that if they don't stop the monkey chanting, they'll abandon the game.
Yeah.
And the ref didn't do that.
I would argue that the ref might not hear it.
Yeah,
I mean, it's a big space of football ground.
But this is the point. Touré was furious.
Oh, he brought it to the attention.
And he told the ref, monkey chants.
Yeah.
And the ref should have, according to Platini. So Platini's being quite active, even though we do know that generally
not a war with FIFA at the moment, but the point about FIFA is FIFA are about to celebrate 110 years. What are they celebrating 110 years of? I tell you what they're celebrating 110 years of is that in the year 1904, you can read the minutes online of the FA's of the home nations meeting that they're approached by FIFA, who ask them if they can use our rules, the four home nations. They ask the International Football Rules Committee, which still owns the rules. So here's the deal. And someone should spell this out to FIFA, is that, let me give you an analogy.
They don't own.
I'll give you the analogy.
They
nicked
it.
No, wait. Here's the analogy, They've been licensed to make it. They don't own the recipe. If it was Coca-Cola, they'd run a lot of bottling plants around the world. They'd run a lot of franchises. But you know what? They don't own the recipe.
That's true.
They're co-owners of the recipe. They have equal votes on the International Football Rules Committee. They're not all powerful. We licensed them the rules back in 1904. And by the same token, the FA should flex a bit, as should all the other three home FAs, because they could always take the license away. They could always say, do you know what? We believe in some of your dealings. You're bringing the game into disrepute. It annoys me still that the referees have FIFA on their shirts. I don't see why the same body that's in charge of clubs and football should also be in charge of the law. I think it's a very dangerous thing, a FIFA-approved football. No, it should be the people who gave us the rules that have to approve referees, and they approve them for FIFA to take. This idea that FIFA just controls everything. No, they're bottling the stuff. They don't own the recipe. Gav.
Good point. Very quickly, because we have to go to a break, the third item today on Back in Black, a referee called Saad Al-Fadhi in Kuwait fought back.
Okay.
He punched a player. They all surrounded him, started pushing him for a pretty reasonable decision for a penalty right at the end of a game. Between Al Nasser and Al Arabi.
Nice.
And he
it was good brilliant. Trivia, Gav.
He knocked over. He properly decked one of the players. Yeah. It's the funniest thing you've ever seen.
It's all over the internet.
It's on YouTube. It's hilarious. You've got to check it out. But I think we need to go to a break.
He kicks him, punches him, and then hands out four red
That's
cards.
Right. Nice. Yeah, it was brilliant.
Is that really to show his anger?
He chins the few players, then red cards them.
But isn't the red card psychologically blood anyway?
Then he red cards the manager.
Yeah, he does.
That's brilliant. When that red car goes up, that's what gives the crowd the reaction, because literally someone's drawn blood and they must leave. They are now dead to the game. Yeah. They saw red. It's like a pink mist from someone who's been assassinated. Woodman, thank you very much for Back in Black.
Involved by calling the warm-up with Johnny Vaughan on 08717 22 3344, or email us via talksport.com. You can tweet us at TS Warm-up or text us at 81089. 50p plus normal sending charges apply.
That was this week's warm-up. I am wannabe Nigerian diplomat or East European manager, Johnny Vaughan. You were...
Gavin Woods.
The Woodman.
I am going to be James Brown.
When you're feeling better.
Anyway, that was the warm-up.